Good afternoon, future colleagues.
Oh my God.
Welcome to all parents, friends, and family members joining us today. Also, a special hello and welcome to our guests joining us for the live video stream. In particular, joining us from China, Saudi Arabia, Palestine. Welcome to the Valparaiso University College of Engineering Senior Design presentation. My name is Adam McAlpine, and I serve as an instructor for this course, along with the civil engineering professors. Professors, please raise your hand when I call your name. Professor Wright. Professor Weiss. Professor Algebra. And Professor Grossman. This course would not be possible without your hard work and dedication to the students. And I'm thankful to be a member of our senior design teaching team. Civil engineering is a broad career field, and it is generally categorized into five primary disciplines of structures, transportation, geotechnical, environmental, and water resources. The plan of study at Valparaiso University has exposed students each of these disciplines during their past 4 years so the students can determine more about their unique interests after graduation. The senior design projects are required to include a minimum of three of these five disciplines in order for the project to qualify as multidisciplinary. Senior design is a two-semester capstone class completed during the final year of the student's undergraduate education. The students are required to choose a discipline and work on teams to accomplish the needed design work in consultation with their faculty advisor. The course is structured to challenge the students and help them develop their project management and design skills. I sincerely hope it was a positive experience for each of them, but if not, students are welcome to try again and repeat the course.
Oh my God.
Join us again in the upcoming fall semester. Please let Professor Weiss or I know if you are interested. One of the goals of the course is to help the students understand they are future engineering professionals. In fact, a portion of their grade is based on their professional behavior. Well, what is it? What is a professional? To help create some clarity to that question, I presented to the students at the beginning of last semester what I like to call Mr. McAlpine's six P's of professionalism. They are present, punctual, polite, positive, polished, and persevering. During their future work life, they will be expected to be present at work in a punctual manner with a polite, positive attitude for their coworkers. And they will need to be polished in order to deliver their thoughts and ideas clearly. Lastly, they will expect it to persevere through difficult times and use their ingenuity to come up with solutions. Colleagues, I hope your future careers are filled with interesting adventure and unique challenges. It has been my pleasure to serve as your instructor for this course, and I have enjoyed getting to know you. In closing, maybe it would be best to leave you with some inspiration. I had found the video I'm about to play has always lifted me up when I need motivation. So I hope it does the same thing.
Adele, who's that?
Jacob.
It's no sound still.
No sound.
Yeah, why don't you just come up here and tell us? All right, we're going to come back to this one because I don't want you to lose out on this. All right, maybe during a break. We will have some. breaks, we'll have a couple of teams present. There will be some refreshments in the hallway, an opportunity to get up, stretch your legs. So I hope you enjoy the presentations today. And I bring you the first team. And we'll take Jeff.
And then those students who are not presenting can exit through the door and spend the time.
Okay.
So the project that we were working on for this past year was the East Chicago Superfund site. So this is located in East Chicago, which is about 25 miles west of Valparaiso. And so the Superfund site is a area of land that the Environmental Protection Agency, the EPA, has deemed contains some hazardous materials that need to be cleaned up and taken care of. And so that was our first pass of this project, was kind of Jasmine figured out a plan to help clean up the soil and groundwater from lead, arsenic, and hydrocarbons. And then the second step of that project was then to redevelop that plot of land, about a 13-acre lot. And so we designed a office building, the parking lot for that office building, the driveway into that parking lot, the foundations to make sure the building doesn't settle, doesn't sink into the ground, and then also my part was to make sure the drainage works properly. And so without further ado, I'd like to hand it off to Jasmine Ramirez to start it up and explain the part of the project.
Hello everyone. As Chris said, my name is Jasmine. I work as the environmental engineer on our project. I'll start off by giving a brief overview of some of the constraints I've worked with during my design. So the EPA mandates that the maximum amount of lead and arsenic allowed in soil is 400 milligrams per kilogram and 26 milligrams per kilogram respectively. And the maximum amount of lead and hydrocarbons allowed in groundwater is 0.014 milligrams per liter and 0.002 milligrams per liter. Contamination at Riley Park exceeded all of these levels, which is why remediation was required. In total, we'll be treating approximately 897,000 cubic feet of soil at Riley Park and 527,000 gallons of groundwater. To remediate for the soil, I opted for a soil washing process, and to remediate for the groundwater, I selected two separate processes. The first is a flocculation system to treat for the heavy metals, and the second is a carbon adsorption system to treat the hydrocarbons. So there are three main phases in the soil washing system. The first is pre-treatment. We're planning on excavating the entirety of Riley Park 2 feet down into the ground. And we will initially put that soil through a soil grinder, which will literally grind the soil up to make the particles smaller. And the reason we're doing this is to make it easier to wash, essentially. After we grind that soil, we will send that soil through a washing process. We'll have 7 total tanks, and what will happen is the soil will enter the tanks, and we will use water mixed with hydrochloric acid as our washing fluid, and this completes what's known as acid extraction. Finally, after that soil has been cleaned and the metal particles have separated from the soil particles, that soil will pass into a gravity separation system. We will use 4 total units, and what this will do is it will literally use gravity to separate those metal particles from the soil particles. The first phase of our groundwater remediation system is the flocculation system. This has a series of tanks, as you can see right here. Initially, the groundwater and the wash fluid from the soil washing tank will pass through a pH adjustment tank. The reason we're doing this is because we're adding acid to the wash water. We're anticipating the water will be acidic, obviously, and it'll need to be neutralized. After the water has been neutralized, it will pass onto a flocculation tank where metal particles will separate from the water particles as we mix the fluid rapidly together. And those metal particles are going to clump together and float to the surface. After that, the water will then flow into the clarification tank, which will remove the metal particles from the water. Metal particles, along with other sludge accumulated during the tank, will pass onto a sludge thickening tank, where sludge will literally be thickened. And then it will pass onto a sludge dewatering tank, and this will finalize that separation of the liquid and solid phase, and we will have our metals and other sludge ready to dispose. As you can see right here, coming out of the clarifier is an effluent. That'll be the clean water free of heavy metal contamination, and it will pass into a carbon adsorption system. What this does is it has carbon mesh located here in a carbon bed. The water will flow downward into it, and that carbon bed is going to adsorb dissolved organic contaminants. The reason the carbon adsorption tank comes after the flocculation tank is because heavy metal particles can ruin, for lack of a better term, these carbon molecules, and it'll allow us to not have to regenerate that carbon bed as often. In total, the remediation for water will end in about 15 days, and remediation of soil will end in about 45 days, and my portion of the project will cost approximately $6 million. I would now pass it on to Matt Wegman, our geotechnical engineer.
As Jess said, I'm the geotechnical engineer for our project. And as the geotechnical engineer, I was tasked with designing the foundations to support the building and the shear walls. Shear walls are a block wall used to resist lateral forces from wind. So there was a few things I took into consideration while designing my foundations. And the first was to ensure that the building would not settle more than an inch. So I did not want the building to sink into the ground more than 1 inch at all. I also wanted to ensure that the foundation, individual foundations would not settle settle too much compared to another foundation, which would make the building not level. So I also wanted to ensure a factor of safety would be greater than 2.5. A factor of safety is it's basically a factor used with geotechnical foundations to ensure that the foundation is strong enough to hold the building, and it's kind of like a cushion that geotechs use. And the total cost of my project was $200,000. So the first thing I designed was spread footings. And the spread footings, I had to use those to support the loads of the column. And there were 6 different loads coming from 45 different columns. And I was able to consolidate my foundations into 3 foundations. And those foundations were a 5x5 footing, a 6x6 footing, and a 9x9 footing. And the footing were buried 2 feet under the ground, and along with the depth, which was 16 inches for the 5 foot by 5 foot foundation and 18 inches for the 6x6 and the 9x9, that brings the foundations below the freezing level, so freezing and thawing will not affect the foundations and cause cracking. So I also had to size the pedestals. The pedestals are this part of the foundation here, which brings the foundation up to the ground level where it can be connected to the column. The pedestal for the 5x5 was 20 inches and 26 inches for the 6x6 foundation and the 9x9 foundation. So I also had to improve the soil on the site to ensure that the soil would be strong enough to hold the building and the foundations. And to do so, I used a sheep's foot roller, which is an example of one that can be shown here, and that greatly improved the soil conditions on the site. So I also had to design the slab that was on the ground, the ground floor slab. And that slab was 7 inches thick, and the steel reinforcement that's inside the foundation, or the slab, was only used to ensure that the foundation wouldn't crack, and is not, doesn't actually provide any extra strength for the foundation, or the slab. I also had to design a shear wall, and Eric will, or strip footing to support the shear wall, and Eric will talk more about what a shear wall is when he presents. And the shear wall weight was 13,000 pounds per foot. And the length of my strip footing varies with accordance with the shear wall. And again, with this part of the foundation, there is minimum reinforcement used as well. And now I'd like to pass it off to our structural engineer, Eric, to talk about his structure.
Thank you, Matt. As previously mentioned, my job was to design the 50,000 square foot office building for the project. The office building is two stories, where the building is 100 feet by 250 feet with around 45 I-shaped columns running throughout the structure, where it's spaced at 35 or 30 feet long north-south and 25 feet east-west. As Matt mentioned, I designed shear walls as part of it. What a shear wall in my structure basically is like these masonry blocks behind us in this structure. It's basically really strong connections to make it so it can resist the lateral loading of the building, so earthquake or wind doesn't affect it. I designed, instead of the standard beams and girders for a structure we have where it's structural shapes, I chose to use built-up joist sections, which you can see here. They allow the loads to be reduced so the weight of the members supporting the building isn't quite so high. For the roof, I have just standard truss shapes for it. And for the floor, I actually have something a little more. On the floor, there is actually, on top of the joist, actually sits metal decking, and on top of that, concrete. For at least the floor. For the roof, it's just built-up standard roof sections. But for the floor, it's actually a composite system where the joists are actually have metal bolts essentially welded to the top of the joists running throughout the entire floor, where there's around 5,000 of those bolts welded, and those are then welded to a wire mesh that sits inside the concrete to allow it to be used in compression. Because while concrete is really good in compression, but really bad in tension, so it would, having it in the wire reinforcement welded to the mesh and in turn welded to the joist, allows it to use that strength of the concrete. And you can see here the studs sitting on top and spaced about every 2 feet throughout the building. And now I will pass it off to Matt Scarcella to tell you about the transportation aspects of the project.
Thank you, Eric. For the transportation engineer, I was tasked to design the parking lot and the drive-up for the site. And right here is a picture of my parking lot and drive-up. So the parking lot itself has 150 parking spots along with 5 handicap spots. And the size of the parking space are 10 feet by 20 feet. And for it to get all this, I used a design vehicle of a single unit truck versus a U-Haul truck. And my site entrance is located right down here on Grizzly Avenue. That was found using a traffic impact study, which is used to figure out how your added traffic to the site will be affected for the area surrounding it. And then right here is my cross section for my parking lot and everything. And it will be on a surface, an asphalt surface, on an asphalt intermediate. And under that will be an aggregate base. And the whole entire parking lot is sloped 2% away from the building, so all the water will flow off into the rain gutters, which Chris will explain. And that's the parking lot right there. I'll pass it to Chris to talk about the water resources.
So as the water resources engineer, my main job is to kind of deal with all of the drainage on the site, just to make sure that there's no like large puddles around or the building doesn't flood, such as that. And so, kind of as I was doing that design, some of the main things that I had to consider was I had to treat the first inch of runoff. So like when there's a parking lot and like cars are there and like a lot of oil might build up on the surface or other contaminants. That we don't want that just to kind of flow right onto the ground and infiltrate, because that doesn't like help. That it leads to the contaminants being in the ground. So I was using rain gardens mainly to treat that first inch of runoff. And then another thing I had to consider is I had to retain about 90% of the design year storm. So my design year storm was the 100-year storm, which means that it holds 90% of the runoff from a storm that happens roughly every 100 years. And so for my rain gardens, I had about 26,000 square feet of rain gardens scattered throughout my site, with most of them around the parking lot. As Matt had mentioned, the parking lot's graded so that the water flows right into those rain gardens. And the rain gardens are very similar to a regular garden, but they have a little bit of a depression in the ground, so like just a little bit of a hole so that the water can like be held there for a short period of time so that it has time to infiltrate into the ground. And then it just acts as almost like a filter, kind of taking out some of those contaminants. And a lot of the plant types of plants can also help take out a little bit extra of those contaminants. And then all the overflow from those rain gardens then go into the retention basin. So this is the cross-sectional view of one of my rain gardens. And so you typically have a thick layer of mulch just to kind of make sure that the soil doesn't just get washed away. And then you have the planting soil for both the plants and also just to help with infiltration. And then same with the sand bed level spreader. That's just to make sure that the water can infiltrate evenly throughout the base of the rain garden. My retention basin was to hold all that water just so it doesn't just get washed out either into the street or some other than that. And so all the overflow from the rain gardens are piped to that retention basin and then held there for enough time so that it can all infiltrate into the ground. So typically that it'll just be a nice, there won't be any water in it, but like right after a storm, then it might be just like a small little pond. And so that water can infiltrate all the way into the ground. I also designed all the piping for the site, so that includes those pipes that I use to take the water from the rain gardens to the retention basin. And then also I designed the wastewater and water mains that go from underneath the road up to the building. And I also had a small culvert that ran underneath the entrance to the site, just to help the water flow from the rain gardens on the far side all the way down to the retention basin. And then finally, I had a green roof on the site. So this wasn't actually on top of the building, but the green roof is basically, they're small planters that go on rooftops, basically. And that kind of helps hold some of the water and also treat some of the water before it gets washed away. And so we had a small little picnic area that we had, and so I put the rain gardens there. So those will be mainly used just to kind of show the people in the area between the rain gardens and the green room, just a little bit of variety in how stormwater can be treated before it infiltrates into the ground. So this is a typical cross-section of the rain garden too. So you have the plant matter on top and then the growing medium to support those plants. And then you have usually like a little drainage layer too. So like once the water goes through all that soil, then it can get cleared away. And so my section for the project costs about $600,000, and then everybody's total amounts to about $14.5 million for the whole project. And so that is our presentation. And I'd like to bring up my to answer any questions that you guys might have.
So, you know, working as a team, you know, and I'm sure you had deadlines and you had other things you had to worry about. What was the greatest thing you learned from this effort that you did in your professional life?
We'll break down structure for sure, so we all and share it with each other, so all of us know what needs to be done, what it needs to be done. I think that helped hold each other accountable as well as ourselves. I think that was the biggest thing I'll probably bring to my professional life.
Yeah, I'd have to say communication. That was one of the main things that we needed to do. We needed to make sure we were in constant communication with each other, so that way we all knew what each other were doing, we knew what hasn't been done, what has yet to be done. Needs to get done and started getting done. So definitely communicating with your group mates and your advisors, getting help when you need it.
I have a question about transportation, kind of combined with the infrastructure of the building. Like how many, like I guess like how many people can like park in the parking lot, and how does that stack up to like what kind of capacity you expect to have within the building?
So for an office building, there is a trip generation daily use. You get the number of cars going on and off the site usually for like new design. And from that, you determine what parking spots are needed just based on that. So that's kind of how you go about it, trying to figure out how many people go to and from the building.
And for the structural side, I didn't really design like any specific office building layout. I would allow any, if there was an architect or person involved with that, I would allow them to do that instead. And they would be able to say, okay, this is how many office people would be working there or visiting there. And that would be probably something similar to what Matt would be able to generate from that manual.
Of the $14.5 million, what were the engineering fees?
It's 12%.
Yeah, let's go with that.
Two trees.
Yes. I have a question on the soil remediation. When you are running the water through the carbon, does that carbon need to be replenished or replaced at some point? When does it get that contaminated?
It will. It'll get less contaminated since, like I said, there won't be metal particles going through it to ruin it. But it probably will need to be replaced. I believe it's once a week, once every 2 weeks, kind of depending on the level of contamination initially going into it.
So how do you dispose of dip? Because it's going to have contaminants, right?
I'm sorry, dispose of the...
The carbon.
Oh, we were planning on putting that in our solids to disposal and kind of sending that to a plant to dispose of. That's the standard.
So when designing your building, do you also factor in the local climate as well, so snow loads and wind loads?
Yep, I definitely took that into account. I designed it for like around 20 pounds per square foot of snow.
Okay.
So just because the area has a lot of snow, I also took in the wind and unlikely effect of earthquake happening to the building.
For sure.
For the lateral stability system, what led to the decision to go with shear walls as opposed to like X braces or chevron braces for a steel structure?
For mine, I wanted to allow to have lots of window spaces and open areas to not have the building have areas where it's just like a brace just blocking the view. The shear walls would allow it to be in certain areas. I forgot to mention that there are shear walls in the interior of the building where the elevator and stairs would be in the bathroom as well, so that would also reduce how much blockages there would be through the flow of the building.
I have a question. How deep was the foundation?
Oh, it was 2 feet below the ground, and it added with the 18 inches of depth, brings it below 36.
Okay, so how do you bring in the factor frost wall, which is 36 inches?
It was, it's 2 feet, so 24, 24 plus 18,
38. 38. So if we get a
front, we'll be okay. Yeah. Okay. All right. Thank you, guys.
Valparaiso School Board and Valparaiso Community Schools. The location of this school is, if you look at this map on the bottom left here, here's Valparaiso University, which is where we are at currently, and then south of US 30, take a left on 2, and our school is just off of Indiana 2? I can't remember. So that's the location of our school there. And the reason they were looking for a new school was because the city of Valparaiso was growing and there were overcrowding problems in some of the elementary schools, and so they were looking to add some more space. And also, there wasn't an elementary school on the south side of the city, so this allows for shorter commutes for families that are living on that side of the city. So an overview of our site, we had 4 design components: the building, parking lot, the foundations, and the stormwater management. The site area is about 25 acres, and we developed on the eastern part, so we developed about 11 of those acres. And the total project cost was about $21.7 million. And each member of the group will talk about their portion of the project and how that cost breakdown occurs. So without further ado, Luke will be talking about the structural portion of this project.
Hello everyone, my name is Tim Prugel. I was the structural engineer for the Hevelin Elementary School project. The structural scope for this project was to design a one-story elementary school that would have the capacity for 500 plus students, faculty, and staff. So codes that I used for this project were ASC 716, which was to determine the design loadings that would be used for the structural analysis of this project, NCMA Tech, which was used for all masonry wall systems, and Steel Construction Manual 14th Edition, which was used for all steel members. A few design criteria that I put up here that I had to consider. This is a Category 4 building. That is the highest level of for the categories of buildings. It was to provide the safety needed for an elementary school as they're to protect the children in case of natural hazards and the like. Snow load for this area is 22.7 pounds per square foot, and the design wind speed is 119 miles per hour for Valparaiso. So when considering how to design the layout of the school, I took into account through research that we had about 51 square foot per student in each classroom, which then I used to have a number of 32 classrooms. As you can see on the slide, the green areas are all the classroom spaces that I designed for the school. The final design of the building was 101,235 square feet. It also includes spaces for a gymnasium, cafeteria, office space, teacher's lounge, abandoned art and choir room, and a kitchen. And that was to provide for the students and faculty in all areas. Throughout the design, I had to consider two major components, what materials I would use for this design, and also what load systems I had to consider. So the materials I considered were steel, concrete, masonry, and timber. Steel is lightweight, durable, and very strong. Concrete masonry, it has a great aesthetic appeal and also is very strong, especially for one-story applications. Timber was considered for about a week, but due to the loadings that were going to be on the system by the wind and other gravity loads, they had I decided not to be looking into that, and I determined to use steel and concrete would be the best alternatives. For the load systems, I had to determine what I would use to determine for what would be holding the structure together. Our lateral system would have to support everything that would be the wind from the side of the building that would exert pressures, and all the gravity loads are the snow and other dead loads that would be on top of the roof. For gravity loads, that would be considered with all materials, and for the lateral load systems, I would consider a moment frame, brace frame, or CMU shear walls. The moment and brace frames both had the fact that they can have large open areas, while the concrete masonry shear walls, while not as open of an area, would still provide that nice aesthetic and also would be very economical due to how having large amounts of the concrete masonry walls with very little rebar to reinforce them. I determined that for the lateral load systems, I decided to use masonry block shear walls. It provide that aesthetic look while also providing the structural resistance for the school. And then for gravity load, I decided to use the steel as the material with roof decking, joist girders, and columns for that system. The cost for the structural portion was $1,806,000. That included all structural members. The finishing cost, that is for HVAC systems, flooring, everything to provide a more realistic estimate for our project, as it's going to be a school that you want carpeting, HVAC, all those other things to make the school look very nice for the kids. That was estimated using RS means, and that was $15,830,000. I'll now pass it off to Quan Tao to talk about the geotechnical portion.
Great look. I'm the geotechnical engineer for the project. So, as you know, this is the footing in the construction site, like this. And also, this is the three-dimensional model of the footings. So, that's what I'm going to do in the project. So, for the geotechnical part, the scope is to design the footing for a one-story elementary school. And it will have the capacity of holding 550 students and faculty. Also, holding the weight of the whole buildings. Now this is the design aid for my design. So the minimum factor of safety is 2.5 for the bearing and bearing pressures. So the bearing pressure is the loading that applied under the applied on the whole area of the land. Also the next is maximum settlement will be 1 inch. The settlement is when the building is on the ground, the land will decrease its volume, and the maximum decrease will be 1 inch. Also, the floor depth in the whole building area is 36 inches. The floor depth is because the area here, considering the weather condition, it will be frozen. The water will be become the water will be frozen at this depth. So that means I need to avoid the frozen, so I need to add more depth for the buildings. The water table underground from the origin is 8.5 feet. These are two many aids I used for the whole design. It's the ACI code and my textbook. Now this is according to the soil profile, the boring log given, I generate the soil boring log like this. Here is the water table, and this is the topsoil, and it's the under the ground. So we can see from this, we can see that the topsoil is mainly the silty clay, and also there are the silty sand. That means it, they are very stiff under the ground, so I don't need to do the soil compaction works. So it will cost some money. So it can cost a lot less. So this is the plan view for the whole building. So this part of that is there are the footings. Also, the PU is just a bearing pressure. I got it from Luke, the structural engineer. And the total number of the footings is about is 65 footings in here. Also, I designed the slabs in here. The slabs dimension is 6 inch in thick, 6 inch thick and 4 feet in width. And it covers all part of the building here. The attention to this part because this is empty. And also, this is the header joint for the whole building. I mentioned the depth, cross depth before. So this is the pedestal. I added this depth right here to avoid the folding. So the footing here will be safe if there is folding. So this red part here is the column, so holding the wall footing, whole building in here. And the green, a little bit blue here is there are ties right here, just like the reinforcement here. And also this green part in the bottom. And this is what it looks like from the top to the bottom. The different footing size of that is 5x5, 6x6, and 7x7, and 8x8. Square foot. The shear wall footing is this place because they are so the outside of the building they are shearing wall. So I also designed the shear wall footing to hold this weight. So the footing, the process is almost the same. So I just put the pattern outcome. And also the dimensions are two, three, and 4 foot is this length, and the whole length of the just like the width, and the whole length of them are just a bit long. All the wall here, they are the length for the so the whole cost of for the geotechnical part is $1,540,000. This is my geotechnical part, so guys. Welcome, Jerry, to introduce the presentation.
So, I'm Jerry, and I'm in charge of the transportation project. So, my purpose is to provide the companion transportation and the safety for the student and the faculty and the staff in the elementary school. So, my scope of work is to design the parking lot and also including these two intersections and the driveways, the entrances. Also, I need to develop the transportation effect after the school is built, and then collect the feedback from the clients or the residents around the elementary school, and then to revise my design based on the feedback. So I came up with several alternatives for the parking lot. This is my main design. So you can see the first picture. I used to use the one parking lot for the cars and the school buses, and the one driveways and the one entrance. For the second picture, you can see I just used the one parking lot in front of the main building and the one driveway and one entrance. And the third alternative, I use two entrances, one big parking lot behind the building, and then the two driveways. And then the fourth one, I use two parking lots, one for cars and one for school buses. And also two driveways, two entrances for the car parking lot, and then one driveway and one entrance for the school bus. Also, this is the fifth alternative. So you can see it is kind of similar to the fourth one. But, well, but they are in different locations. So this is the C6 alternative. You can see there are three entrances and one emergency jogging. And also a stop, the stop area for the students to let their parents to pick them up. After considering those alternatives and then and collecting the feedbacks from the clients, I finally decided to use this. So you can say there are there is one entrance for the car parking lot, this part, and this is car parking spots, and these big spots are for school buses. So for school buses parking lot, there are two entrances. It make the school bus more convenient to just drive in and drive out. So based on the requirement, there are six accessible parking spot. Oh no, sorry. And the total parking lot for the car parking lot are 221. And there are nine parking spots for the school buses. And also there are two bus drop areas for the students. Just make the school buses can drop the students more convenient. And then in order to keep the students safe, I add four crosswalks. So two are in the car parking lot and two are in the school bus parking lot. So for the driveways, all of them I use the two-way driveways because, well, it is more convenient to make the cars just drive. So the total area for the parking lot, including the car parking lot and the school bus parking lot, the total area is 110,000 square feet. And also, I designed the intersections after I evaluate the transportation, and then I decided to use the runouts. After the school is, before the school is built, the level of services was A, and then after the school is built, the level of services of these two intersections are C, and then after I used the runouts, they went back to A. The definition of the level of services is, in my opinion, I think it is how fast you can drive. So A is the best, and C is okay or fine. Yeah. And the total cost of the parking lot is about $410,000. So this is the picture of the pavement and the parking lot structures. There are several alternatives for the material for the pavement and the parking lot. After comparing all of them, I decided to use asphalt for the surface and the base for both of them. So I used 1/2 inch asphalt surface for the pavement and 2/2 inch for the Albert base for the pavement, and then the 4 inch for aggregate base, and then this is the solid brick. And for the parking lot, I use 1/2 inches asphalt surface, and then 3 inch asphalt base, and then 6 inch aggregate base, because, well, the cars are more heavier, are much heavier than people. Then I will pass it to my project manager to introduce the resource.
Thanks, Jay. So looking at the water resources management for this project, I was in charge of a couple of goals. One was reducing stormwater runoff, and then I decided in my design selection to include providing community educational opportunities. So since it's a school, it's kind of a center of community for a lot of people, so using the stormwater management of the site as a way to promote water conservation and environmental stewardship and things like that. So first of all, some of the reasons that we need to reduce stormwater runoff in the first place. When you build on a site and you have parking lots and buildings and things like that, a lot more water will run off of those surfaces. Those are called impervious surfaces, than would like grass or woods or things like that. And so it also decreases the quality of the water because there are, like someone was talking about earlier, oils and heavy metals and things from vehicles on the roadways. There's dust and all sorts of other particles that accumulate on rooftops. And so as water flows over that, it collects those pollutants and takes it with it wherever it goes. And so we as stormwater engineers have to figure out what to do with that. In addition, on our site, as you can see here, we have three protected wetlands, as well as a creek that runs through the site. And so that produces some extra challenges in protecting those local ecosystems for the site. So we're going to talk about, I use six different practices on my site. I'm kind of going to breeze through all of them, because that's a lot to talk about in just a couple minutes. But the first two are urban trees and rain gardens. They both have similar positive qualities. One of them is that they increase infiltration, so they allow water to collect and then infiltrate into the ground. Urban trees, I use 15 of them, spaced about 30 feet along the roadway, and then rain gardens, about 4,000 square feet in total on the site. And also, both of these, as long as you're using native plants, can allow, can really help benefit the local ecosystems and promote those local species on your site. Next two we'll look at are green roof and impervious pavement. So green roof, we had 65,000 square feet covering our roof, and kind of what that looks like is it's essentially like this picture up here. You've got grass covering your rooftop, and that keeps the water from collecting in plants, like I was talking about earlier in the first place, and then it also has a lot of other benefits like contaminating your building. Filtering the runoff as it goes through the green roof system, and also makes use of a space with tops that typically goes under space. Another one of my favorite things to research for this project was impervious pavement, and the pavement that I chose eventually was one that's made of recycled rubber, and so they take locally sourced tires and shoe soles and any other forms of rubber that is no longer in use, and they shred it and they make a pervious pavement out of it. So this was used on the playground areas on our site, and it also it has a little bit more give to it than a typical pavement, and so allows for better safety for students. We have 36,000 square feet of this pervious pavement on the site. Last two things I'm going to talk about, first one is rainwater systems. I calculated about the amount of water it takes for our building for non-potable use for our Bobby Beach, and so we have rainwater cisterns to collect that amount of water, which is about 35,000 gallons. That can be used for bulk irrigation of the site, as well as toilet flushing and other non-potable water systems. And then finally, we have an underground storage system, and this primarily was used to protect the wetlands, like I was talking about earlier. Instead of sending our runoff to the wetlands, which was kind of their option, or creating a detention pond and removing the wetlands completely. We allowed all three of those wetlands to stay on the site and then use an underground storage system under our parking lot, which then increases infiltration, as we're talking about, removing contaminants from the water and protects those wetlands on the site. And that is about 32,000 square feet buried under our parking lot. So looking at kind of a rendering of what this might look like. These are the urban trees here along the roadway, the north and south portions of the site. You can see where I have wind gardens located. The green parts of the roof here, that's the green roof. This red is the pervious pavement. And then buried under the parking lot up here would be that underground storage system, as well as the rainwater cisterns. So that's kind of an overview of the stormwater design. It was all designed for the design storm, which in northwestern Indiana means about 7 inches of rain over 24 hours. So if with that amount of rain, you wouldn't have flooding issues, and a proper amount of water was treated for water quality in that storm. The total water resources cost was about $2.1 million. And with that, I'm going to ask my team to join me back up here and answer any questions about that.
So, if by any chance that there was a rain
stormwater engineering, you design for what is considered to be the biggest storm that you might expect on your site, but the way a lot of these things are designed is they have overflows, and so in the case of a larger storm, the water will then overflow and it would end up going to a storm sewer or being transported to a local creek or water system or something like that. So we try to avoid that if possible, but in the event of a larger storm, that's what would happen.
The elevation differences between that stream that runs through and where your building is going, because South Bend, for example, you probably your number is your main blockage,
yeah.
200.
Yeah.
And that's just two counties over. So what's the elevation?
The creek on our site has a, I didn't have an elevation, but has a steep drop off into the creek itself, and the water level is pretty low naturally. So there's, I want to say something like 6 or 8 feet of elevation difference between the creek water level naturally and just the upper part of the creek bed, and then our building is higher than that. So that's naturally the way the site kind of flows.
I'm sure the operators of school board said they love the design, but I can't afford what you're asking for price here. He's considering contingency of what you would remove your design in order to get a lower number.
So a lot of our cost in this design is for the finishing. With that cost, that was an estimate based off a construction cost estimator tool. And that, depending on what this were decided was applicable for the project, that's how they determined this is what we actually want. None of us are architects or interior designers up here. So we did an estimate to try to best show what, if they're trying to create the school, what that cost would be. Don't know. This school was actually built down on Hebel Elementary, and it was about their final cost was about $17 million. So ours is a little bit higher, but we did have a more conservative estimate, especially with the finishing, and that can kind of all back in. Be altered by those architects slash the interior designers for that part of the project.
So with the underground water storage, what kind of depth do you have to go down to store that amount of capacity?
So like the foundations, The system that I was looking at is a concrete system that's built in the ground, so you want that to be below frost depth. And it's really flexible. So for us, that means build 36 inches into the ground, and the way I had mine designed was 3 feet deep of storage, but you will find underground storage systems up to 10 or 12 feet deep. So it really is a flexible design. The way I designed it, it was 3 feet deep. It could be a lot more than that as well.
And so you have to accommodate into that as well, the climate factors. You have to be at least 3 feet below, so none of that freezes.
Yeah, with concrete you have the problem of freeze thaw. If things are freezing and thawing around it, you'll crack your concrete. So that's a big concern with that structure.
When you do your parking lot, do you take a survey or look into how many in that area will actually be riding a bus compared to how many school being dropped off in a car?
I did a research online about the average, so the student will take the bus in America, so about they're about 50 or 55 to 72 students will take school bus to the school. So I assumed one bus can contain about 70 students, and then I use 500 students times the 52, the lowest number to get, no, sorry, the maximum number to get the student, the number of the students, and then divided by 70 per bus, and then get the bus number. That is the number that I get is from the data that I researched online. So it is an average it is on average.
Yeah. Mine is called. Is that a U.S. average or an Indian average?
Oh, U.S.
Okay, on that green loop. Now, I know you're going to put grass up there and everything, but it's going to hold more water, and it's going to, you're going to have to use heavier steel to hold it, right?
Yes.
Yeah, sure. Sure. So, oh yeah, so this can kind of show, I don't have my exact drawings up here. So, I designed all, where our green roof is, it's in this wing, and then it's also in this wing.
Okay.
I designed everything to be able to support the loads that a green roof would have.
Now, cost effective, how is that cost effective?
I compared it to like what normally like the loadings would be and how it would alter like compared to the joist. And it was very minimal, the sizes that had to be increased. Like there was very little change in the amount of sizes produced in the green roof. Because of how I had spaced out the structural components, the cost change with the sizes was very minimal. And we actually designed this section of the roof to actually have, Chris had mentioned it, but we actually designed it so that students can actually go up onto that roof and have that educational experience so that they can learn about the green roofs and have that for just future understanding. And so we were able to maximize the space. The reason we didn't do all of it was that you had to have a little bit more, like they were a little bit larger, but we were able to maximize then our the amount of space that we had with impermeable areas.
Impervious area.
And so we were able to maximize that with by having that green roof area being a majority of the roof.
Okay.
What type of maintenance does a green roof require?
Just like any stormwater management practice, it takes maintenance on occasion. You have it, it'll clog up occasionally, similar to rain gardens. And so I don't know exact standards on that. It's something like every month or a couple months or things like that. There would be someone who would have to inspect it and make sure that it's draining properly.
Now,
this
green roof, just like they paint the top. So school bus is white, it uses the heat inside the bus. What is the yearly kind of cost savings for heating, air conditioning, because you have a green roof?
That's another number that I don't know. But I do know that typically in urban areas, they will use these a lot as a method of cost savings for heating and cooling systems.
And a question about parking. Where do parents drop off your students in your design?
So in the car parking lot, they can just drop when they park their cars. And if the students take the school bus, they can drop the students in the bus drop area.
There are two driveways. Between those, this column, this one, and this column parking spots, so there are enough space for the parents to drop their children in the parking area, and then they can just go along the driveway and then use the crosswalk to get into the building.
I have another question about parking, actually. Regarding the placement of the handicap spaces, why are they not like immediately adjacent to school? Why are some of them farther away from the other?
I mean, when I designed the accessible parking spots, so I just want to make them close to the driveways because, well, it is more convenient for them to drive out or drive in because, well, the parking lot is designed for the parents. It is not for the students, I think. So the parents, I mean, they don't need to go to the school to have classes. So they just drop their children and then they can leave easily. Does it answer your question?
Thank you. Yep. Yeah, that's great. to meet you. Thanks.
In the crowd?
Alternatives that I use to handle the rainwater. These are the four alternatives: a rain garden, permeable pavers, which is fancy words for bricks, bioswales, which is more fancy words for a ditch, and detention ponds. So here are the constraints. First of all, you'll see here in the second bullet of each of these are how I found these amounts of water. So in water resources, we design for quantity and quality. So quality of water, you know, are there pollutants? Is there toxic chemicals? All those bad things you don't want to drink. And then quantity is how much water? Is your property going to flood? So in terms of quantity, which is called flood control, we use the 24-hour 100-year storm. And that is a requirement from the Valparaiso, the city of Valparaiso, their technical standards manual. They require that we use that type of storm. And so just to tell you what that means every 100 years, a huge crazy storm comes along, and that is the biggest storm of those 100 years. We're designing for that storm, as if that would happen. And we're designing as if that would happen for 24 hours. And so Krista was telling you earlier that for her area that was about 7 inches of rainfall within that time, and that's directly from this type of storm. Now for water quality, we just take the annual rainfall. So like I was saying, here's the total storage that we have to account for. That's 2 million gallons, that's 2 million, you know, big gallon jugs of milk, but it's water. And 400,000 gallons that we're treating for. So these are the manuals. I've already mentioned this top one here. That's the City of Valparaiso standard manual. Pretty much every county or at least big area is going to have a manual like that, and Valpo's manual tends to be really nice, so they did me a lot of favors in the design. Here are some of the other things that I referenced and kind of was looking along as I went through my design. And let's get right to it. So the four things that I was telling you about earlier, the rain garden, number one, number two, the fancy bricks, number three, the ditch, and number four, the pond. There's actually two ponds. So we'll start with the rain garden. Here's a cross section of the garden. You can see here, so I'll go back one slide. On the front of the building, you can see these drain spouts. All the rainfall lands on top of the roof of the building, and there's a rain garden on the north end and on the south end. That rainfall comes down the building, across the sidewalk, enters this pre-treatment, it's just a concrete bathtub of rocks, really. And as it fills that up, it goes over that weir and spills into the rain garden. So the plants can pull the water that drains through this catchment, or if the rainfall is too much, it will overflow into the rain garden. Now, if the rain garden overflows, it'll enter this spout, and that shoots it out to the detention pond. So in order to account for all the rainfall from the roof, which is what I was trying to treat with the rain gardens, that ended up being 4,000 square feet on the north end of the building and another 4,000 square feet on the south end of the building. So moving on to the pavers. These are kind of a double kill when it comes to treatment of water and storage of water, so the quantity and quality. So the way that you design these pavers was according to a manual, and the way that they recommend you design it, this actually happens a lot in engineering, is you look at maybe even two methods or sometimes three methods. You go through the design with all those requirements that they ask you to do, and you take the one that is the most conservative, the best case. So to explain that, they ask for a structural analysis and a hydrological analysis. So that's how much water is going to be on this parking lot and how much weight is going to be on this parking lot. So I looked at if, you know, a bunch of garbage trucks are coming in to take out the trash, that's going to be this many pounds. And we designed it with weight. Then we designed it with water, and I picked the thicker of those two designs. That's kind of standard practice for engineering. You'll typically go through multiple designs to even get to the very end. And then the only other details that I want to tell you guys about the parking lot is it's sloped away from the building. So as this dirt fills up with water, as the rain comes in, it'll fill up this gravel here, and these pipes have holes in them. So the water will fill up the gravel, enter the pipes, and go out towards the surrounding ditches, which will route it towards the detention pond. And if the water overfills beyond that, it's still sloped away from the building, so as you guys were saying before, that overflow is routed to keep everything from flooding. So, moving on to the ditches. They're called bioswales because they have plants that are growing in the bottom trench of them, and they typically will treat pollutants within the water just by the water soaking in, and those heavy metals or those chemicals are absorbed by the plants and pulled out of the water. So the bottom of this trench would be lined with plants, and they can make it to the area. So for the rain garden, we're using hydrangea bushes, and I believe for the swales, we're using a type of grass called barberry. So that would be lining the bottom of the trench around the entire property. Now, this trench was modeled, the dimensions were modeled to account for all the water that is coming from the rainfall and anything coming from the parking lot in that 100-year, 24-hour storm. So these dimensions here are modeled to make sure that nothing overflows, even if that huge storm comes along. Now, my last one I wanted to tell you guys about is the detention ponds. So there's one small one here, which really is more aesthetic. I just like water features. So if you ask me what would be the first thing I'd cut about this site, it'd be this detention pond here. But the second detention pond is really the kicker. It's the big one. So we have to account for 2 million gallons of water in that huge storm. And that arrives with an 18-inch pipe, so that's something like this. Pretty big pipe. And the second detention pond is out on the far east side. So Sturdy Road is right out here, and we're connecting this Sturdy Road with Silhavy Road, which is way up there. Closer towards Silhavy, yeah, is where the second detention pond would be, and that's sized to account for all the remaining water in that storm. And there it is. So just to give you guys a little bit of an idea, the road comes along through here, and Silhavy runs along here. The wetlands are at the bottom of the hill here, which is why the detention pond is at the top of the hill. So as all the water comes in along the side of the road, it fills up the pond, and even if the pond overflows, it dumps it into the wetland stream, and it's safely accounted for. And finally, the cost estimate. All of this came out to $800,000, and that's with work and labor. And that accounts for as much as I could get into with the cost analysis program we could, as much as I could account for I put in. And that even includes plants, the trees that you saw in the 3D rendering. So that's as detailed as I could get. And now I will hand it to Tanya, and she'll tell you all about transportation.
So I'm going to introduce some transportation design for the Eastgate property. The main goal for the transportation design include a signalized intersection in Sturdy Road and a new road which we have named as Eclipse Drive. The Sturdy Road and Sturdy Road. And also a parking lot in the both sides of the new building, which divides the highway. So let's start at some design criteria. So all my design, according to the requirement from ASHTO and the requirement from the City of Valparaiso and Department of Transportation of Indiana. So let's start at the intersection. This is the intersection right now. There's like any people who just cross this, not this intersection? No, okay. So there's just an intersection. People cannot just cross to this road. So what we designed is a signalized intersection after we analyzed the factor of safety, the traffic delay, the social impact, and the constructability. So signalized intersection is the best choice than the tunnel or a roundabout or a footbridge. So after the intersection design is a road design, which connect the Sturdy Road and the Silhavy Road. It has a total length of 2,603 feet. The width for the road is 27 feet, and it has a speed limit of 30 miles per hour according to the requirement from City of Valparaiso. And it also has a sidewalk, which is 8 feet in the south part of the road. And for the pavement design, I chose an asphalt pavement. So the most two common pavement is asphalt pavement and concrete pavement. So why I chose asphalt pavement is because the biggest advantage is it's really cost effective, it's cheaper. And the second one is as we live in the north, we got a lot of snow in winter, right? And a lot of ice. So it's really easy for concrete to crack or upheavals. So asphalt is not that easy to crack, and it's also it's really easy to maintain. You just need to reseal it. So this is the road design. So this is floor. This is 30-year-old, and we are here, and this is 16-year-old. So this is after. After we connect the chapel drive over here and the roller maker port over here. So after the roller design, a building, it's really easy for people who live around here to go to shopping in Halls and Menards, so which make people's life much easier. And for the parking lot design, the total area for the parking lot is about 66,000 square feet. It has total 170 parking spaces, which included 12 handicap parking spaces over here. So you can see from this drawing. So six handicaps in both sides of the building. And also we have 30 bicycle spaces in the corner of the building. And the part, we have a planter island, so this is grass. It's 20 by 20 and 20 by 40. So we also have an 8 feet pedestrian crossing in the planter island. For the pavement design, we chose the permanent pavement in the parking spaces and the asphalt pavement, which connect the parking spaces. So this is parking lot design, and the total construction cost for the transportation design is about 1.65 million. I will pass it to Jack to introduce some geotags.
All right, so as Tommy just said, I'm Jack Worth, a geotechnical engineer on this project. So my two main goals were, I have to make sure that I make a foundation that will support the weight of the building, and I also have to make sure that my foundation won't break under that load. So here's the design work that I did. So I had all the different alternatives that I had to compare and see which one was best. And the things that I came up with were the spread footings, ship footings, and the slab for the floor. And then I have steel that goes with all those three things above it, but I promise you that it's all adequate and it's good. I'm not going to bore you with all the spacing and the sizing. So for my alternative analysis, I compared piling to mat foundations to spread footings. So for the piling, it's usually has a high capacity, but it's expensive, it's loud, it would make all the neighbors really crazy because it's right there. So I decided not to go with it. The mat foundation is like the spread footings. Basically, it's just one solid piece of concrete slab, and it's underneath the original slab to make sure that it doesn't move. Spread footings are actually just little squares, as you're going to see in a second. And I decided to go with that because it was cost effective, and it was going to be sufficient. So this is what a spread footing looks like. So there's going to be a load coming down from the columns that Mike was going to tell you about in a little bit. And you're trying to take that load and spread it out so that it doesn't sink into the ground. I decided that we were going to use a 2-inch settlement. And we complied with that. It'll show you in a second. So the dimensions that I used for the interior was 8 foot by 8 foot with a 16-inch thickness. The exterior footings are going to have a little bit smaller size because they have less weight on them, because you're only getting it from one side, not both sides of the footing. So I made those 6 foot by 6 foot, also with a 16-inch thickness. So here are the loads that were on these footings. So on the interior, there was 91 tons, and it goes down 1.59 inches with the size footings that I used. The edge columns are going to get a 1.67-inch with 57 tons on them, and the corner columns have 30 tons on them with a 0.46 inch settlement. So for the strip footings, Michael, and as you've seen before, there are some shear walls. So to support those shear walls, I made sure that I made strip footings for that. So the highest force was 8 tons per foot, and I made that 5 foot wide so that it would support that load. And the floor slab. So for the floor slab, it's 120 feet by 240 feet and 6 inches thick. Those first two dimensions, that's the size of the building. And I had to ensure mostly that it wasn't going to crack. It was basically for sure going to support the weight of the live load and dead load inside of the building with people going through it and your cabinets, your desks. But the biggest problem is that it's so large and it's concrete and it's brittle. It's like a saltine cracker and it just wants to crack. So I made sure that adequate reinforcing bar in it so that it wouldn't happen. So here's just some of the pictures.
So that green at the top, that's the slab, the floor slab that I made. That's going to tie in with the pedestal that connects to my foot. So this is the larger interior. It's 8 foot by 8 foot. And you'll see that I made a 3 foot pedestal down from the original ground surface. So that would be the top of the footing is below the frost line, where the ground is going to freeze in winter. Here's a 6 foot, same thing, just a smaller size. And here is my strip footing. So the main difference here is that it's a different size at the bottom, it's 5 foot. It's going to continue for the length of that shear wall. And instead of having one pedestal that connects to the square section, it's going to be basically a wall underneath the wall. So for my cost. So the concrete was $125,000. The earthwork to move everything and excavate all the dirt out for this, $38,000. Forming and framing, about $39,000 for all the concrete to put into these molds. And so the grand total was $203,000. All right, now I'm going to pass it off to Michael Walls, our structural.
Thank you. As the structural engineer for this project, I was tasked with designing a two-story mixed-use building. Now that gave me a lot of flexibility on what exactly I wanted to design. So I chose to design a 120 foot by 240 foot building that gives you 57,000 square feet on both floors. And that includes 8 retail units on the ground floor and then 2 offices on the second floor. So this is the floor plan for the first floor. You can see these are the retail units on both sides. You have a mechanical room here for all your equipment. And then here you have a lobby leading up to the offices. So this space is open all the way up to the second floor. As you can see here, this space is open looking down. And then you've got the elevators and the staircase coming into these 2 office spaces on the second floor. For my design considerations, one of these was the dead load. That's the weight of your flooring materials, your walls, and all of your structural members. You also have your live load, which for this office building was 100 pounds per square foot. Now to give you some reference, that's equivalent to 24,000 adults standing on the second floor of the building. And obviously, you're never gonna have that many people there, but I just wanted to illustrate the safety that's built into these designs. And then the snow load and the design wind speed are both based on the location of the building and its use as an office building. And so my snow load was 20.79 pounds per square foot. Not as bad as that, but you do have some lake effect snow which bumps up that. And then the design wind speed of 114 miles per hour. For some of the other design considerations were the deflection limits. So when you put a load on a beam, it'll sag like that, and you want to limit those because you don't want your floor to sag too much. You don't want that to affect doorways and walls and everything. So the maximum deflection that was allowed was 1.07 inches, and the maximum deflection that any of my members had was 0.67 inches, so well below that maximum. And then some of the architectural considerations for this building, such as the type of facade I can use, the number of windows needed, all came from the City of Valparaiso Unified Development Ordinance. So then last semester, I considered different alternatives for the material to use for the structure. I considered steel, concrete, masonry, and timber. And after doing some preliminary design work on those, I determined that steel was the best option, both for the cost of it and to allow me to meet some of the architectural and other requirements that I wanted. So some of the members designed roof joists. Those are these truss shapes here. I had that supporting the roof and supporting this metal decking there. So the metal decking for the roof, I had one type, and on that you've got your insulation and your waterproofing materials built onto that. And then for the second floor, I had a larger type of metal decking because the loads were greater, and on top of that you had a concrete floor slab.
the beams and girders that I designed. So in this image, it kind of shows how a load travels through a structure. So you've got your load down on your floor slab, which is distributed to these beams, which then go out to your girders, which are basically just bigger beams, which carry more load. And then those go into your columns, down into your foundations. So I used I-beams for the beams and girders, and those ranged in length from 7 feet up to 32 feet based on the location in the structure. And there were 14 different sizes of I-beams that I used based on the different loadings and lengths. And then for the columns, I decided to use, instead of using I-beams, I used the hollow square tubes. So that's just hollow steel in a square shape. And some of those columns only went up to the first floor, so those were 15 feet tall. And then some of them went all the way up to the roof, so those ones are 26 feet tall. And there were 3 different column sizes based on the different loadings. Now into the connections. If you were at the cookout earlier, you probably saw a large orange structure back there. And this is a picture of it. It's a bunch of different steel connections and steel members. This one is pretty accurate to the connection that I designed. You've got a plate. So these connections are to connect the beams to girders and then the girders to the columns. So you've got a plate here. My designs only had 2 bolts as opposed to these 3. And then this weld length would vary based on the different load. So I had 5 different types of connections with 5 different weld lengths, depending on what it needed to carry. And then into the shear wall, this was to protect against your wind loads and your earthquake loads. So those, you know, your wind will blow on your structure or you'll have an earthquake shaking the building back and forth. And those loads are transmitted into a shear wall. So my shear walls were all located around the elevator and staircases in the building. I had a total of 8 shear walls. And these were all constructed out of masonry blocks. So going into the construction cost, the cost for just the structural materials, so all of your beams, all of your columns, was just under $2 million. But then when you added in all of the HVAC systems, the plumbing, the electrical, all the finishes, that brought it up to a total cost of $8.8 million. And then for the general overall construction cost for this project, including all of the different disciplines, we got to just about $11.5 million. Now, that's a lot of money, so why is it worth it? So the impact on the community, there are pros and there are cons. The positives are the road connection will alleviate traffic along Sturdy Road. It'll allow people to take a different route if they're going over to Silhavy. As Tanya was saying, it provides better access to retail along Silhavy Road. And then with the retail units and the offices, there's greater employment opportunities and tax revenue for the city. And then some of the negatives of this project are during construction, there will be construction noise and traffic, which can affect local residents, as well as there are some houses that are pretty close to our site, which could be impacted by this development and the new roadway. But we found that the pros outweigh the cons in this project. So I would like to invite the rest of my team back up to answer any questions.
Yeah. In terms of the light intersection, I'm not sure if like this is part of the project you guys delve into. Like, do you do anything in terms of like the timing of the light and like the logistics with that? Anything?
No, not about the light. After the signalized intersection are built in, they will have a system to determine like how long the yellow light, how long the red light, or how long the green light will last. So it's not my direct.
Yes.
Also for those intersections, do you consider doing roundabouts or another type of intersection versus stoplight?
Yeah, I realized that signalized intersection and roundabout and the foot tunnel and tunnel. So
all four of them, the signal light intersection has a better like level of service, which means it will have less traffic delay and it will have less traffic accident. So I chose the signal light intersection.
Yes. Is there a specific use for the building and design of anything that you guys discussed? Like a couple of the projects with specific ideas as to what that would be used for?
Yeah, so as I was saying, the scope of the statement said two-story mixed-use building. So I consider different things, because since it is a university property, I look, do I want to do dorms? Do I want to do apartment-style housing? But I've been talking with them, we just kind of decided that having retail and office would kind of bridge the gap between university and community.
Yeah, and we reached out to the university initially when we first started the project just to see one of the reasons that this was on their radar and why it was even something that was a project for senior design. And one of the things that they first said was, of course, what Michael just told you, but they were also considering maybe there was some kind of sports involvement. If you remember the satellite view, there was kind of those fields next to it, like a soccer field and things like that. So that was one of our questions. We're like, well, are they going to be using it for maybe like some kind of impromptu field house or something like that for one of those fields? And pretty quickly they got back to us and said, no, we will not be. So that's how Michael arrived at that kind of office or business kind of application building. Yeah.
This is probably going to show my engineering ignorance, but with the shear wall, with the wind shear wall, it seems like all the shear walls were inside.
Yeah.
Why wouldn't they be on the outside where the wind is?
Yeah, so.
Like I said, I'm showing my ignorance.
No, good question. So the wind pressure, we'll talk about wind, not earthquakes, it'll hit the side of the building, and then that transfers through the floor, slab, or whatever, into the shear walls. The reason I didn't put my shear walls on the outside was I kind of already had those walls. Like for elevator and firecase, or staircase, you need that to be fireproofed and everything, so I was planning on having either concrete or masonry there anyway, so I decided to just turn those into my shear walls. But it's transferred through the floor system into the shear walls.
I have an online viewer question. I've been told to ask, what is likely to degrade first if the 100-year flood lasts more than 24 hours?
All right, so the first thing I would say that would degrade probably be the rain garden. If the rain garden was over flooding, it would be ripping out plants. I mean, those spouts can only handle up to, you know, the 100-year storm. So anything beyond that would start to flow over that rain garden. Thankfully, the whole parking lot is sloped away from the building, so the building wouldn't flood. And there's a perimeter ditch, so that would catch any of the water, which would send it out to the pond, which would send it out to the wetlands, if even that flooded. So there are a lot of fail safes that would kind of account for that, but you probably lose a lot of your hydrangeas.
The roof of the structure seemed to be a pretty standard flat roof. Would it be possible to incorporate green roof features or solar panels, and do you think that would require major changes to the structural elements?
So regarding the major changes, so we had looked at that a bit during our last semester alternatives analysis. Ultimately, we decided not in discussing with our client. But so adding a green roof would increase the loads on the roof because you've got all the plants. You've also got more people going up there to clean it or just to enjoy it. Same with the solar panels. You've got to do maintenance and you've got the weight of those. So I would have to look at how that would affect my loads. And then, if need be, increase the size of the joists. But it, yeah, so it would affect it, but I would have to see how.
Yeah, Brad.
So for the, I noticed for your different sizes of footings, they settle with different depths. So how do you kind of account for that in terms of building design?
So it's called angular distortion. And so you have to see how far each one moves in relation to each other.
Okay.
So there's the side, the corner, and then there's also the interior. So they're all going to be moving at different rates. And basically you find the distance, and then the difference in change of their how far they're set up. So then you take that as a fraction, and mine was 0.001 slope difference. So if it goes over that, it would assume that it's actually a fraction of the foundation of the floor slab, and the doors not fit anymore. So it's a big deal, and it kind of puts cracks in there. So that is a common theory.
Okay. Okay,
information. My name is Eric Johnson. I'm Dean of the College of Engineering here at Valparaiso University. And 5 years ago, the college entered into an agreement with the Dalian Jiaotong University in China to start a joint program with them. And it was a program where it would be mechanical and civil engineers would spend 2 years in China, and then they'd come and spend their final 2 years here at the university, some of the students. And so the incoming class 4 years ago had about 50 civil engineering students and 50 mechanical engineering students. And after 2 years, about 10 of each came here to the U.S. And you're seeing, if you're wondering why there's some Chinese students in the groups, you're seeing the first cohort that's coming through. And so of those 10, I think 9 in civil and 9 in mechanical will be making it and either graduating this May or this December. So it's a great program. We actually teach some of the classes to them in China. In English, so they get some chance to hear some of our professors teach them in English engineering classes. And then the top 10 in mechanical and civil come here and finish their degree program here. I know at least in the civil engineering, a couple of the students are, I think 3 of the students I know are going on to graduate schools in the future, and the rest are looking for either positions here in the U.S. or back in China. So I just want to give you that little bit of information. I think it's a great program. It gives our students a chance to work with students from other cultures, and it gives the Chinese student a chance to see what it's like to be here. So, anyway, thanks again for coming. I really appreciate the time you take to come here, and I also appreciate all your sons and daughters. It's been a joy getting to know them over the past 4 years, and you should be very, very proud of them. Thank you.
Everyone, we're Big Dog Engineering, and our project was the St. Joseph Energy Center Water Treatment Facility. The team, I'm Nick Prodich, your project engineer and the environmental engineer.
I'm Andrew Wong, the structural engineer. I'm Blake Wong, the Water Resources Engineer.
I'm Patrick McCardle, the Geotechnical Engineer.
Some background about our project. It's located out in St. Joseph's County, which is over in South Bend. It's in a town of New Carlisle, Indiana. It's a 1,400 megawatt power plant. It's going to serve about 500,000 homes. The total size of the power plant is 165 acres, and our site's about 16. And the owners are Aries, EIF Group, Development Partners Funding, and Toyota. Here's the location of it, here's the actual power plant, and here's our site down here. So here's our scope of work that we were charged with. For me, environmental, I was treating the water for boilers and cooling towers, along with human waste and other waste produced by a treatment plant. The geotech's in charge of foundation design. The water resources is in charge of designing detention ponds and permeable pavements. And the structural design is in charge of designing the building. So to start off, I followed some criteria for designing my portion of the project. I followed EPA standards, ASME water quality standards. I used the NELCO water handbook. I used GE design guides. And I followed NFPA standards. To start off, I figured out my water demands. And as you can see, the cooling towers take up most of the water at 15.6 million gallons. The boilers will use a little over 500,000. And I budgeted 106,000 gallons for drinking and fire suppression. And the treatment plant will produce about 165,000 gallons of wastewater. Now to start off, here's a process map of everything that's going on. Water will be pumped from the wells and sent to the pressure filters, where it will be treated for iron and manganese in the water. Most of it will be sent off to the cooling towers, with some of it being stored for fire suppression. The remaining of water will be sent to the RO system, which will be further purified for the boilers. So here's an example of the pressure filter in my design. They are going to be 12 feet in diameter, length of 25, and the flow rate through the system is 4.42 gallons per minute for every square foot. 8 of these are needed to treat all the water required for the entire power plant, and each one costs $100,000. Here is the finished product right here. For RO, I will be using a GE system called the GE Osmos Pro 50. It has a feed rate of 563, and it produces 450 gallons per minute of clean water for the boilers. They're 80 by 267 by 102. Two of these units will be needed, and their cost is $350,000 per unit. Here's a good example of one which we'll not be using. I also did sewer design to get rid of wastewater that's going to be produced by the plant. I estimated that to be 165,000 gallons per day. The run of the sewer, my new sewer main, is 3755, and that's going to run to an existing sewer line that goes to South Bend. It's going to be PVC, it's going to be 3 inches, and the velocity through the sewer line is 3 feet per second, and the cost of that is $45,000. Also, that's going to be needed for the sewer line is a lift station, which essentially helps the water go over any vertical changes in elevation. So the head that's going to be used to get, or the head that the lift station will produce is 55 feet, which will get over any elevation changes and any head loss in the system. The well depth is 10 feet. The volume in the well is 1480 gallons, and it's going to run every 15 minutes, and that's going to cost about $100,000. And as you can see here, here's our site. It's going to run to Walnut Drive, and then run up Walnut to the existing one, which goes to South Bend, Indiana. I also did fire suppression for the project. I figured out the office space, and then figured out how many heads that will be needed. And from that, I got the gallons per minute that will produce. And the standard is to run 2 hours. So I got the total gallons that are going to be required to be stored on site. And so a tankless size and a cost of $400,000 was estimated for this part of the project. And lastly, for my design, the client requested to have a generator on site. So we always maintain power, so the power plant can always produce power and need water. So a Polar brand was chosen. It's a 1300 kilowatt, 60 hertz. It's a diesel, it's going to be an aluminum housing, and the cost of that is $500,000.
Now we pass it off to Pat to talk about geotech design.
Okay. So, for the geotechnical portion of the project, I was supposed to design a foundation system for the building and the water storage tank and pedestals to transfer the load from the columns and the tank walls to those foundations. The criteria was to control for settlement, bearing pressure, and angular distortion. A settlement is how far into the ground the foundation sinks. Angular distortion is the difference in settlement between two foundations relative to their spacing. And bearing pressure is how well the soil can handle the load. The frost depth was 36 inches, so we had to make sure they were that low into the ground to avoid frost problems. And the steel reinforcement depth must also be so that the foundations can support the loads from the domes. So you can see we have a soil profile here. We have SPSM sand, pretty strong stuff, pretty deep, really the only relevant layer. There's also a small layer of clay that will have to be excavated, so there will be a little bit of cut and fill, but not a very large amount. The loading for these foundations are 99.5 kips for the edge columns, 50.2 kips for the corner columns, and 2.05 kips per foot around the wall of the water storage tank. So the alternatives we have were to do shallow footings, which could be either spread or strip footings, or deep foundations, which are piles. You can see there is an example of a spread footing, a strip footing, and piles. Spread footings were selected for the foundation for the building, and strip footings were selected for the foundation for the tank. Deep footings just were not needed. The soil was strong enough to where we didn't need them, and they are more expensive, so we just went with the shallow foundations. There you can see our foundation plan, different sizes for corner and edge columns, and the strip footing going around the circumference of the water surface tank. The methodology used was for the horizontal dimensions, the process from Essentials of Soil Mechanics textbook, that effectively was designed so that the soil could handle the loads of the columns. Now for the steel reinforcement, pedestal design, footing depth, we used the ACI 318-14 codes, and that effectively ensured that the actual footings could handle the loads that would be placed. And here you can see an example of one of our corner columns. They are 4 foot by 4 foot, 1 foot thick. They have steel reinforcement in two directions, and they have a pedestal connecting them to the column. For an edge column, very similar design, just 5 foot by 5 foot, a little bit more reinforcement, but the same exact pedestal will be used for those. And for the water storage tank, it is a strip footing, so it goes all the way around the circumference of the tank. It's reinforced in both directions as well, longitudinal and perpendicular to the circumference. It has a different pedestal design because of the nature of being a strip footing than the other two folks. The analysis found that all of the criteria were met for the corners and edge columns and the strip footings. And angular distortion was assumed to be negligible for the water tank because the soil conditions are uniform and the load is uniform. And for the columns, the angular distortion criteria were met. For the cost estimate, this is a very conservative estimate. You can see that the largest portion of the cost comes from topper dams. That's due to the high water table, so water will have to be dealt with when pouring these foundations. I'm not a contractor. There may be a more cost-effective way to complete this construction, but I just went with the conservative cost estimate. And with that, I'm going to pass it off to Blake, our water resources engineer.
Okay, so for the water resources, the scope is to design the stormwater treatment facilities for the energy center, both for the water quantity control and the water quality control. The water quantity control, also called flood control, has required a rainfall which has a 100-year recurrence interval, 24-hour lasting period should be controlled. And the purpose of the design is to protect the properties away from flood, includes a main building and water treatment equipment. According to records, the rainfall depth for the design site is 5.5 inches. With the data, I determined that the water volume is about 37,000 cubic feet, which is the water we should control. the water quality control, as required, we should treat a 1-inch depth of rainfall as required by the client. We don't want the stormwater like this or this contaminates our groundwater. So the purpose of the design is to filter the runoff pollution, include the hydrocarbons, heavy metals like lead, zinc, and nickel, and the nutrients like nitrogen and phosphorus. After calculation, I determined that the water quality volume is 7,200 cubic feet. Next, I will talk about what I designed to control and treat the stormwater. Here are some design alternatives I proposed. I consider to use a dry detention pond, wet detention pond, and a retention pond for the flood control. Use the bow swell, rain garden, permeable pavements, and green roof for the water quality control. I graded each alternative according to their performances, safety to human, environmental impacts, construction costs, constructability, maintenance, and aesthetics. Also, different ways were distributed to each item according to their importance. After analysis, I determined to use the dry detention pond for the flood control, use the bow swell and the permeable pavements for the water quality control. Here's what a dry detention pond looks like. Without a rainfall event, it's always dry like this. During a rainfall, it detains the water and keeps the runoff at or below a desired rate. It can hold the water for a short period of time, like this. Then it will discharge the water through the outlet pipe and infiltrate through the soil. The cost of a dry detention pond is always less than a retention pond. Also, compared with the wet pond, the dry detention pond doesn't have a drowning hazard or mosquito risks. My design follows the City of Appraisal Stormwater Management Manual. As the plan view shows, the bottom length of the pond is 120 feet. The width is 60 feet. The side slope of the pond is 3:1, which is the horizontal distance to the vertical distance. And the total depth of the pond is 4.5 feet. Next one is the bow swell. It's always located at the side of the road, as the pictures show. The bow swell filters the runoff pollution through the soil and the plants to improve the water quality. It also enhances the landscape aesthetics. Here's the bow swell cross-section area which I designed. The bottom width of the swell is 8 feet. The depth of the swell is 2 feet, including 18 inches maximum water surface elevation and 6 inches freeboard. The side slope of the swell is 4:1, and the total length of the swell is 270 feet. For the permeable pavements, they have a good performance at parking lots pollutants removal. In my design, I determine the material and the thickness of each layer for the permeable pavements. Finally, the total cost for the water resources design is about $509,000. Then I will pass it to Amber to talk about the structure design.
So, good afternoon, everyone. My name is Amber Wong. I'm the structural engineer of the Big Dog Engineering. So, my design objective were to design a 13,300 square foot office building and a 500,000 gallon water storage tank. So, without further ado, I would like to share some of my design with you. So the first thing I did was to find out the possible alternatives for the building and the tank. So for example, for the building, it can be reinforced concrete, or it can be conventional steel building, or it can be pre-engineered steel building. Well, now some of you may ask, what's the difference between a conventional steel and a pre-engineered steel? Well, here's a picture of the conventional steel, and this is a pre-engineered steel. Now you may see the difference. Okay, so it's pretty obvious if it provides more space inside, and in this case you won't run into a column or a wall when you're walking and texting at the same time. So that's pretty awesome. And in this case we happen to need a space for the big and tall water treatment facilities, so that makes it even better. So to make sure we choose the best alternatives, we look into this criteria and we give them score on each criteria. Including like cost, constructability, environmental impact, and performance, and all that. Obviously, pre-engineered building wins, right? So
So we go ahead and design a pre-engineered grading. So based on the area of footprint is 13,300 square feet, I determined the length to be 190 feet, and this about 3 times of the width, which is 70 feet. And the maximum load is determined to be 72 pounds per square foot. And based on that load, I determined and calculated, selected the required construction elements I need. So to better illustrate what I designed, I borrowed this picture from the Rigid Building Company. So as you can see, there are 4 columns on the ground to support the upper section. And the girths over here attached to the side of the column. So to transfer axle load, and it can attach the wall flapping on them. And also there should be two roof rafters here. There you go, two rafters here to support the roofing material. And next, we have the cable braces at the side of the wall to resist lateral load, such as wind load. And we add roof purlins on the top to supporting the roofing material. And then we repeat the procedure depending on how many bays you have. In this case, we will have 5 bays. And then we add wall insulation and wall panels, as well as roof insulation and roof panels to make sure the heat will get out in the winter. And then we add more finishes and details, so we are officially done with the design of the building. Then move on to the cost estimate. So in this case, we will use a standard assembly cost with RS means data, and it includes 3 parts, the floor construction, roof construction, and wall construction. So the total cost we get is $570,000. So the next design elements of the structure site is a water storage tank. The possibility of using a welded steel tank or a reinforced concrete tank is discussed. And we use the same criteria we used for the building to evaluate. So we decided to use a welded steel storage tank, which is basically a liquid containing system by welded steel. And it consists of shell plates, base and foundation, and other accessories, such as letters, openings, inlet, and outlet. So once again, the capacity is $500,000. And the inner diameter are determined to be 40 feet, the height is 54 feet, and the shell thickness is 0.25 inches according to the maximum hydraulic pressure developed at the bottom of the tank. And the standard we use is American Water Works Association 100. So in this case, we'll use a tank from the Superior Tank Corporation, which has a capacity of over 500,000 gallons. And the cost is $545,000. So with that, our total cost of the St. Joseph Energy Center water treatment facility is around $6 million. And I would like to invite my teammates Becca to answer your questions.
Did the client specify they only wanted water quality treated for a 1-inch rainfall? That would seem to be pretty common.
Yes, that's the required.
The second question is on the reverse osmosis system. There is a lot of water as a byproduct coming out of that system. Is that where the volume of water going into the treatment? Is that what are you doing with that?
Reject water that we're talking about?
Yeah, that is heavily concentrated iron and manganese, and it's being transported in the sewer in South Miami.
Can you elaborate on the difference between the dry detention, the wet detention, and the retention pond? What are the differences?
Yeah, so the dry detention pond, so the dry detention pond always looks like this. It always dry without a rainfall event. During rainfall, it can detain the water and hold it for a short period of time, then it will discharge the water through the
there's the oxidized pad here, and infiltrate the water through the soil. But the wet pond, they can hold the water for a long period of time. Like the pond in the back of your yard, they have more landscape aesthetics, and looks better.
And a retention pond, what?
Basically, the retention pond is the same with the wet detention pond.
Okay.
All right, we're going to have one more 10-minute break, and then we'll come back and power through three more presentations. So,
we're going to get some James videos.
And
one might be better. It's okay.
These are my parents.
Hi.
Nice to meet you. Oh, sorry.
It's okay. Nice to meet you.
Yeah, nice to meet you. He's been in office a few times.
Yeah.
To be fair to him, my ear is more structured.
Yeah. I'm in skill design with Professor Wicker. They're very good.
I know nothing about any of it. It was enjoyable. I think you guys did a fantastic job. Really?
Yeah, your organization is walk around the models.
It's exactly the same. Try and explain
great
that
job.
It's
great job.
For a
walk. All right. That's a deal. Right. We'll see the video. Because our daughter goes to school here, too, and we'd like to see her today.
Yeah. Yes,
thank you so much.
Yeah. 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 I got three job offers for Fridays. Next week. That'd be nice, week before.
There's no better time.
That's all good. It's so nice to meet you. She's business marketing. So great, same day as Jack.
Really?
Yeah. She's got a job too. Yes.
We're moving, but we didn't tell them where we're going yet. No.
There's a ball there. Meet the parents, and then you get it. Yeah. It was a pleasure to meet you.
It was nice, yeah.
It was so nice.
The area.
Mom and I'm going to hammock.
Do you have anything for speaker?
Well, I did something with the crunk and got the rest of the I mean, you got like 3 minutes.
I
sure would. It'll take me a second to find it. I'll email it to you. Yeah, I made, so what I did is I just made a little cube out of four little light bulb sockets, you know, and then ran the cord out the bottom. So then you just screw that thing into it, and then I put, you know, kind of lampshades up off the corners, and then put a lampshade around it. And I put the mold off halfway through the curing process, took a steel brush and kind of scraped away the cement between each of the aggregate, and then, you know, let it cure. And then I took this clear coat spray and just sprayed it all over. Now it looks like the concrete is permanent. Now it is just right in. Kind of it's really nice looking. I'm definitely going to be doing that again. It's more busy. I have built a couple other steel
Yeah, because that's like a Okay. Scrape it.
So what do you think of our
presentation? Very nice.
Not a lot of good practice, but also we got so stacked. Our team is so stacked. Jack's confident. Michael's confident. I've been speaking to him. Oh my god.
Job employment, an interview,
and their friends videotapes them so that they can see how they look and then do a retake. So, and then they submit them to me to prove that they did the exercise. And I didn't watch any of them except Jack's. And I thought, oh wow, I gotta use this sometime in the future.
I got some dirt on.
So this is the wisdom that I was talking about. Jack, and he had to use this during his interviews, I'm sure.
Tell me a little bit about yourself. Great. Could you give an example of a goal you accomplished and how you achieved it?
Absolutely. I lost one of the database builds, so I learned Excel macros, and I made that a reality for it. Reduced our big costs, it made us more accurate.
Wow. What is your greatest strength?
I'm a go-getter. If you need something, I will absolutely do it, and I will do it the best way possible.
And finally, if you could be any object in this room, what would you be and why?
Wow. I would definitely be this C5 Corvette. It's powerful, it's strong, it's fast, just like you.
All right, thank you very much.
Consulting. I'd like to introduce my team quickly. I have Jeff Moore, who is our geotechnical engineer, Juzo Min, who is our water resources engineer, Rebecca Valier, who is our structural engineer, and David Tegwater, who is our environmental engineer. To tell you a little bit about our project, we have a 10.5-acre site located in the center of the city of East Chicago, which is about 25 miles northwest of here. And the city of East Chicago has been home to a number of lead refineries and chemical companies, a lot of companies that have put their waste products into the soil of the city of East Chicago. Not a good scenario. So our site has it's been contaminated with lead and arsenic and hydrocarbons, which is a fancy word for oils, and we need to clean it up. So that's part of our scope, is to clean up the site, both the soil and the water that's on the site. And then build forward upon that, we've been tasked with putting a 50,000 square foot building on the land. We chose to make that mixed use, mostly community center, and then work on the transportation network and the water network and the other impacts of that building. So I'd like to bring Dave up to talk about the environmental engineering.
As John said, my name is David Tagwar, and I was the environmental engineer for this project. And I'd like to begin by giving you a brief history and background of our site. Riley Park was constructed on the USS Lead Superfund site, which is the former home of the USS Lead Facility, Crestilli Chemical Company, Delamar Copper Refining Company, and Anaconda Lead Products. Due to historically poor hazardous waste management practices, the site is now contaminated with lead and arsenic both in the soil and in the groundwater. Over the last two semesters, I've designed remediation technologies to reduce the concentrations of these contaminants, and I've estimated the total cost for remediation to be $5.8 million. Now, when we first got this project, my first task was to go through and investigate what different technologies are available to remove these contaminants. So for the soil, I investigated magnetic separation, soil washing, electrokinetic separation, and fire remediation. And for the treatment of the wastewater and the groundwater that seeps into the site, I investigated enhanced bioremediation, chemical oxidation, constructed wetlands, and precipitation, coagulation, and flocculation. For the treatment of the soil, I selected soil washing. And the process of soil washing is that you excavate your contaminated soil and put it in a mixing tank with your wash fluid. Now, the wash fluid extracts the contaminants and carries them away as you discharge it. I designed a system that will treat 120,000 kilograms per day of soil. And I designed a wash fluid as a mixture of water and EDTA. Now, EDTA is a fancy word for an acid that it reduces the strength of the bonds between the contaminants and the soil and gives you a higher rate of removal. And I've estimated the total cost of this process to be $1.4 million. Should have been a schematic there. So, All the water that's produced by the soil washing system will be pumped to the precipitation, coagulation, and flocculation system. Now, what this is that you have all your contaminants floating in the water, and you add a mixture of chemicals that will force the contaminants to stick together in large clumps called flocks. And once you have all your contaminants settled in these heavy flocks, you can either let them settle out the water on their own or force them out the filter. So I designed a system that will use lime and polyaluminum chloride to force our lead and arsenic into flocks. And from there, we'll send them to a coagulation basins where they will be mixed, and then this will allow the flocks to form fully. And then from there, we pump them to clarifiers, which is just a giant filter that extracts the flocks. So you take all your hazardous waste, including your residual acid and the flocks of the lead and arsenic, to a hazardous waste treatment facility where they can incinerate the flocks and extract the lead and arsenic for recycling. I've estimated that this process can produce 0.8 cubic meters of flocks per day and cost a total of $4.32 million. The result of this project that in the soil, you will see a 74% reduction in lead and a 94.1% reduction of arsenic. In the water, we will see a 99.91% reduction of lead, and approximately 100% of the arsenic will be removed. All the clean soil that we produce will be dried out and then used as fill on the site. And then 20% of the clean water we produce will be used on site, sprayed to control the dust. The rest of the clean water meets the discharge requirements set by East Chicago and will be discharged to the sewer. I'll pass it off to Drew, who will talk about the civil site design of our project.
Hello, my name is Drew Zimmerman, and I'm the water resources engineer for our project. To start off, the code that mandated all the requirements for the project was the Lake County Technical Stormwater Manual, and we determined that the total cost for our project, for my portion of the project, would be $1.2 million. And so I'm going to start off by explaining what stormwater is. Whenever it rains, you're going to create runoff because of the impervious surfaces located around anywhere. So that water will eventually build up and cause erosion or other big disasters or issues. So we have to manage the stormwater on our site. So to do that, we went with an idea of infiltration. So with infiltration, it's when the water will flow through the ground and be absorbed into the groundwater. To do this, we went with a rain garden. This rain garden was determined to be basically handle about 3,750 cubic feet of water, and it's located on the northeast side of our site. Any excess runoff will go into our infiltration basin located on the southern part of the site. This was determined to have 9,000 square feet of required area and a total volume of 27,000 cubic feet. It's a naturalized infiltration basin. This infiltration basin has canary reeds and other native fauna located within it. Before that, it goes into the swale. This swale collects also any runoff located on the site and is about 200 feet in length with an emergency overflow pipe located within it. This was designed with the Lake County Technical Stormwater Manual. Located on the roof of our structure is a green roof, and this was determined to have 1 foot of coarse grain aggregate for drainage and perforated pipes within it. The green roof also reduces runoff created by the roof because of its impervious surface, and will absorb it due to like grass or other plant life located on the roof, and any excess will be drained off into the grass located below. Next, I'll pass this off to Rebecca to talk about the structural portion.
As Drew stated, I'm Rebecca Gallier. I'm in charge of the structural components of this project. The structural components are comprised of a 50,000 square foot community center, which is two stories, and a bus station. In regards to our community center, it is a steel brace frame. It is a risk category 2. Essentially, how risk categories go is they go from 1 to 4 based on the importance of the building. 4s are usually associated with hospitals and buildings that are more significant that would cause loss of life if something bad were to happen, so ours is only at 2. In addition, the bus structure itself is under risk category 1, just because it's a station. The design criteria I use for my buildings are International Building Code, the AISC 14th edition, which is because I chose to do steel buildings, and ASC 716, which is just buildings. For the community center, it's located in the northwest corner of the apartment, this area. And the loading is as follows, with a 20-pound silo on the ground that goes 18-pound grain load and size beams, columns, and girders that I have to make. Because between my bed loads are people and what is actually what I'm moving in the building itself.
So it appears our schematics didn't load when we load the presentation. Can you do best just to explain it?
Yeah, I was just going to go back to the slide and I had information, and then I was going to go to that. But essentially, the Camaras Center itself is 125 feet by 200 feet in each direction, respectively. The columns are spaced every 25 feet, and then there's bracing, which is essentially like an X, because you can't see it on here, which is in the center of the columns on the exteriors. And that will be in the center of each of them for each of the dogs. And we'll just skip ahead to the best step, which is just tourist category one. Same loadings, but they're applied differently based on the risk category. And for that one, the schematic is similar, but it's 24 feet by 4 feet deep. And for that one, it's more open in the front, and it will have plexiglass. And that's just going to be an area because we wanted to incorporate a more environmentally friendly transportation aspect. So we wanted to incorporate the bus stopping, which you'll learn more about from the transportation job. But so that's basically what it would look like if it were going to show up. But it will not. I apologize. And I will hand it off to John if you get to learn more about our transportation.
Thank you, Robert. So for the transportation aspects of this design, there were three primary objects that I was in charge of that was designing the parking lot on our site, which I'll talk about the traffic impact study, which I'll get to, and also the pavement design. There were three primary design aids that I used, as listed here. The Lake County Code, this is the governing document that says how anything of structural significance should be built in the county of Lake County. OSHTO Green Book, that's just OSHTO is a governing body that oversees transportation design across the United States, and the Asphalt Institute. And the cost estimate for my portion of the project was just under $400,000. So here is the parking lot, and you should see a schematic right here, but I'll try to explain it. This parking lot has 158 parking spaces located within it. There were 155 that were required for our site. This 155 came out of using that Lake County code that I mentioned, and using their local ordinances. We have 10 American with Disability Act parking spaces, and 9 are required for our site, and those are listed along the side of our building, as well as 5 loading zones, so those parking spaces can be van accessible. We have 2 different design vehicles for the site. We have just like your standard pickup truck that is able to access any parking space on the site, and we also have this 40-foot city bus. So as part of making this community center part of the community, we wanted to not just let the people who live around the community center come and partake in activities here, but we want everyone in the city of East Chicago to have access to this. There is an existing bus line that runs all throughout the city of East Chicago, and it runs right along the north side of our site. So by slightly amending that route, we can bring the bus into the south entrance of our site, and it can pull up right next to our building, and the passengers can get out at the bus stop that Rebecca talked about. And then that bus can exit our site to the east, which is an exit only onto a one-way that goes north, which can get it back on its route. I also performed a traffic impact study. Basically what this is I look at the existing network, the transportation network that we're situated in. So there are 4 different intersections that are within about a half mile of the site or so that are stoplight controlled, and there are a number that are stop sign controlled. And I look at the level of service. So the level of service is a metric that measures what I call the movability on the road. Just like your grading card in secondary school where it goes A through F, A being the best. So to the engineer, we look at basically how bad is the delay to the vehicles, because we want to think about efficiency in getting vehicles through. To you guys who are regular drivers, think about how easy is it to switch lanes. And that'll give you a little bit of context for what level of service measures. So all intersections were a level of service B or better. So B is a pretty good grade. And they were not only B or better for that initial case before we added this to our site, but also after we added this and all the traffic that would come with it, and then extrapolated that 20 years into the future at a growth rate of 1.5%. So in essence, this has a negligible impact on the surrounding transportation network. And then pavement design. So we have two different pavements on site. The first is warm mix asphalt. So warm mix asphalt is a newer technology. Most places, most roads that you drive on are going to be built with hot mix asphalt. Warm mix asphalt, as you can maybe tell from the name, is placed at a cooler temperature. But the big win with warm mix asphalt is that it's much more environmentally friendly. They do some extra chemical stuff, some additives at the plant, and when it comes out, it takes less fuel to produce, produces less emissions when it's placed in the field, so safer for the workers and safer for the community. It's just a win overall. So we also use the Asphalt Institute's standard for a low-use road as a design aid, so there's an inch and a half of surface over 2.5 inches, and that was the depth of the pavement. And then the other pavement we use is pervious asphalt. So pervious asphalt is asphalt that allows water to run through it. So when the rain falls, normally it just will run off, but this actually allows water to run through it. So the voids in that pavement are bigger, which is why the water can go through. It's beneficial because we infiltrate that water. And this was placed on the site underneath all the parking stalls in the parking lot. So this would be the place where you don't have as much traffic traveling on top of it. Cars are just coming on, sitting, and going off. So we can extend the useful life. Pardon me, of the pervious asphalt that way. So that is the transportation. I'd like to bring up Jeff to talk about the geotechnical aspects.
All right, thanks, Jeff. So I was in charge of the geotechnical aspects of the project, so everything that sits on or is underneath the ground. The three major components were the foundation for the building and the bus stop, analyzing the soils to determine if the soils that we had in place already were good enough to support our building or if we needed to modify them at all, and then designing the pavement subgrade for the roads and parking lot. So the alternatives that I selected were the spread footings, which are these little platforms that you put underneath columns to spread out the load across a greater area so that the soils can actually support it. The other alternatives that I considered was a mat foundation, which is you just pour some concrete on the ground and build a building on top of it. And then piles, which are very long columns that you drive into the ground and it supports the building through the friction of the soil. Speaking of the soils that we had in place were fine for building. They didn't need to be modified at all, so we didn't do anything to them. We're just going to leave them in place. And we have the pavement subgrade. So the requirements to have a good pavement subgrade are you have to compact the soil and you have to make sure that it drains. So for my design limits for the foundation, I had to make sure that the soils could actually support the building. So that was, I'd spread the load out so that it was 2,000 pounds per square foot on the pedestal. The settlement can be more than 1 inch, so the building sinking into the ground. And then I had to limit the angular distortion as well, which is the settlement between adjacent columns. Because if you have one column settling 1 inch, but the one next to it is 20 feet away, and only settling 1/2 inch, it does bad things to the building structure. It can bend stuff in the building, structural members, it'll break glass, that kind of thing. So for the cost estimate, I estimate that it will cost around $535,000 for the footing and the slabs on grade. This is all the concrete we need to do on the project, all the formwork, all the reinforcement that has to go into the concrete, and another $225,000 for earthwork. The reason the earthwork is so hard, so costly, that as David mentioned during his section of the presentation, we are doing soil washing for the environmental remediation. So the top 30 inches of soil will have to be excavated, sent to the washer, and then put back in place after it has been cleaned. So for the foundation, and there's supposed to be schematics here as we are having problems. I have designed the slab on grade, which is the pad that the building is sitting on. The pedestals, which is what connects the slab on grade to the actual footing below, which is the actual foundation which supports the building. And then for the pavement design, I took a look at what soils we had on site, which is this right here. That's a classification by ASHCAP, which John mentioned in his
section of the presentation, and those soils are perfectly fine to build parking lots or roads on top of. We just have to make sure that they're compacted and drained. In terms of specific values for the compaction, that requires a Pocker test, which is an analysis run in the laboratory. And since we can't get samples, and even if we did get samples, they would be contaminated with lead and arsenic, which we can't exactly analyze here on campus. I specified the Pocker test, what the requirements were, wrote a summary of it, and included it in our report to be executed by a contractor once the bid is awarded. As the end of the geotechnical section of the presentation, John is now going to give a brief summary of the vision.
So to push our project a little bit further, we use the Envision criteria. Envision is a system which measures sustainable design and is put together by the Institute for Sustainable Infrastructure. So Envision takes a look at a project over its full lifetime. It looks at things like the energy that has to go into the production of the material, but also the energy that has to go into the removal of that material, the recycling. It looks at how the project impacts the community around it, things like livability and walkability. It looks at things like pollutants in the water and what's happening to those pollutants over the whole life scale, maintenance. A lot of the stuff that we've talked about, but it encourages designs to go above and beyond what is like just state of practice. So Drew and I, as part of this project, both took an extra class through the Institute of Sustainable Infrastructure and received our ENVSP, or Envision Sustainability Professionals. So then we took our design and evaluated it for the sustainability criteria against the Envision program. And at the end of it, determined that our design earned a Silver Achievement Award, which is 30% of the total credits possible. So part of some of the things that push points into the category for us is the remediation of what's called a brownfield, basically a contaminated site. We have a lot of points for that. Impacting the community so that it's more livable and more enjoyable for the people does a lot for that. And we worked this in from all angles of our design. And I think the biggest challenge with this was that we were attempting to do sustainable design, not really knowing what sustainable design was. And so we used the Envision Manual guidelines to help guide our design as we were going through it. That's Envision. For conclusion of the project, we anticipate it'll be about $13 million, and we think that this will revitalize the Riley Park neighborhoods and the city of East Chicago for many years to come. I think we learned a lot, and at this point, I'd like to bring my team up to answer your questions.
I would have to probably say just the constant need of coordination between everyone. You need to keep all of us on the same page, keep everyone's information constantly updating, because you have, if one of us does something, it pretty much affects everyone else's project. So if, like, I remember at one point John's parking lot increased, tripled in size, and that creates a lot more impervious surface, so that was a lot more runoff that I had to worry about and figure out and redesign based off of that. And that is more cut and fill for Jeff. And then, so it's kind of that idea of constant coordination and constantly keep each other updated.
We definitely improved at that over the few semesters.
Yeah. What was the basis of treating about 30 inches rather than some other depth?
Well, we had some information from soil borings they had taken, and below 30 inches, the contaminants were a low enough concentration that they met EPA standards already and did not need to be treated.
Two questions for you, and one you may have just answered with hers. The creative aspect of integrating the bus line from the community, besides needing a bus stop, what kind of impacts did that have on the design?
Yeah, so the schematic could show that, but the bus that is in the city of Chicago, the buses that they run are 9 feet wide by, I think it's 45 feet long, and so that bus can only turn on, the tightest radius can turn is 42 feet. So That bus enters from the south side and needs to be able to turn into the parking stall that's alongside the building and then be able to pull out of the site safely. So it comes down to geometric design to make that happen.
The second question is about the reinsertion of the cleansed soil. Do you have to do compaction on that soil so that you don't have the angular twist problems when you put weight on it?
Yeah, you do underneath like the building and the parking lot, the 30 inches is the very top layer. And actually the foundations underneath the spread footings are below that 30 inches. They're down to 36 inches, which is a requirement of frost depth here in Indiana. You need to bury your foundations 3 feet below the surface so that they don't freeze. So you would need to do it underneath the parking lot.
Which is why we include the proper test.
Yep.
Yeah.
So if there was a way your top way to improve your envision ranking for this project, what would it be?
The top way. Envision's a holistic system, so it looks at the project from a lot of different angles. So I think each of us are going to have a different answer to that. And probably Drew and I are going to have the best form of answer to that.
I would say we already did it with remediation. That alone gave us upwards to about 5 to 8% of our points. There's no other really big chunk. The rest of it's about 1% through each question.
Okay.
So
some of it also is just not applicable to our site, like preserving prime farmland. We're already in the middle of a hazardous waste city, so there's no prime farmland. So, big question.
Dark Engineering, and today we're proud to present our final design of the St. Joseph Energy Center Water Treatment Facility. First, I'd like to introduce the Dark Engineering team. We have our two environmental engineers, Adele and Brandon, our two structural engineers, Adrian and Leslie, and I am Jake, the geotechnical engineer and project manager. So a quick background on the project. It's located in New Carlisle, Indiana, which is just west of South Bend, Indiana. On the right here is an aerial image of the entire Energy Center site. The red box indicates the entire property, which is about 165 acres. And the bottom right corner here, in the yellow box, is where our design will be applied. So St. Joseph Energy Center is a 1,400 megawatt gas-fired power plant that, upon completion, will serve about 450,000 households. During the construction phase, it will generate about 750 jobs, and 50 of these jobs will remain upon completion. The total overall investment for the project is about $500 million, with 80% of that coming from Ares Group and 20% from Toyota. So our role in the project was to provide the Energy Center with a water treatment facility to use groundwater in their two cooling towers, which you can see here on the right. So they specified that they needed a capacity of 16.4 million gallons per day of treated water to use. And they also specified they needed a 13,000 square foot, one-story building and a 500,000 gallon water storage tank. So this is just a general layout of what the site would look like. As you can see, we have the one-story building and the water storage tank. The other water treatment systems will be talked about further by the environmental engineers. So my job as the geotechnical engineer was to recommend any necessary soil improvements and design foundations for a one-story building and 500,000 gallons water storage tank. So before I started any of my design, I was provided with a geotechnical report. What that included were just general description of the site characteristics. The field exploration included six soil borings that were conducted on the site, and samples were taken during those borings. Also included a subsurface soil profile, which was just descriptions of what types of soils were at different depths and different tests that were run on those soils to determine their classification. And also groundwater conditions, which just talks about where the water table was on the site, which is about 3 to 4 feet below the ground surface. So with that, I was able to generate a soil profile for the site, which is basically just, it tells you at different depths what types of soil you have. The site is mostly consisting of sands, and I was also able to calculate different soil properties for the different layers of soil, their strengths, and how they would react when being placed under loading. So after looking at these soil properties, I decided that it would be necessary to improve our soils. And the way I'm going to do this is with vibratory compaction using a steel drum vibratory roller you see here on the right. For our site, we have, like I said, we have a lot of sandy soils, and many design manuals recommend this type of soil improvement for this, the sands that we have to is ideal. The effective depth of this treatment can range anywhere from 6 to 10 feet below the ground surface, depending on the weight of the roller that you use. So it's good for improving the upper layers of soil only. This is a very cost-effective method to improve the upper layers of soil, because it only costs about $1,200 to rent one of these per week. So the foundations that I selected for our two structures, for the water storage tank, I decided to use a continuous strip footing along the circular perimeter of our water storage tank. And for the one-story building, I'll use spread footings under each of the building's columns and a concrete slab throughout the entire interior of the building. So first, for the water storage tank, if you look here on the right, this is a profile view of the water storage tank. This is if you cut it in half and look at it from the side. So at the bottom here is what the strip footing will look like along the edge of the tank. So the radius of our tank is 25 feet, meaning that the perimeter of the tank all the way around is 157 feet, which will also be the length of that strip footing. So some considerations I had to keep in mind during my design. First, total settlement should not exceed 1 inch. That just means that the building should not sink any more than an inch after you build it. Also, a differential settlement, which is very important for the tank. Basically, you don't want one side of the building to settle more than the other side. That was very important for the tank because there's a lot of welds in the steel plates of the tank. So if you have too much differential settlement, you get stress in those welds and they could fracture. Also, a factory tape needs to be at least 3, which basically means that the foundation just needs to hold 3 times what you're going to apply to it. And the estimated cost for this foundation is about $84,000. So this is just a closer look at that strip footing. So if you look here on the right, you can see that the footing is placed 4 feet below the ground surface. And the reason we do this is so that we reach below the frost depth, which in this area is about 36 inches. I also had to size the footing to hold the brick, which is called bearing capacity, so you can hold the weight. So at the base, it's 3 feet wide. I also had to design the steel reinforcement in the concrete to give it that added strength. And I also have to keep dewatering in mind. Because the water table is anywhere from 3 to 4 feet below the ground surface, during construction we need to select pumps to pump the water out so that the footing can be placed in dry conditions and be placed properly. Next we have our building foundation. That will consist of 12 total spread footings for each of the building's 12 columns, and also a 4-inch concrete slab throughout the entire interior of the building. So again, we have to keep total settlement in mind, no more than an inch. For the building, differential settlement is still important, but not as sensitive for the building because it can have a little bit more flexibility than the welded steel tank can. The factor of safety for this, a little less than the tank, only 2.5. And the estimated cost for this foundation is about $220,000.
And this is just a closer look at the building foundation. We had two different types, two different sizes of spread footings. On the corners, the four corners of the building, our loading were a little lighter, so we were able to use a footing that was only 3.25 feet wide at the base. And all the other edge footings needed to be 4.25 feet wide at the base. And again, these will be placed 4 feet below the ground surface to get roof below that frost line. And also had to design the steel reinforcement in a very similar fashion to the strip footing. And with that, I'll pass it off to Adele to talk about the environmental engineering.
Thank you, Jake. As Jake said, my name is Adele, and I am one of the environmental engineers. For the environmental engineering portion of this project, we are going to design. We designed groundwater treatment and treatment and disposal of domestic wastewater. My task was to design the groundwater treatment. My scope was to provide the energy center with 16.4 million gallons per day. They are broken up into four units. The cooling towers will receive about 15.6 million gallons per day. The boilers will receive about 0.56 million gallons per day, and drinking water room use is about 0.156 million gallons per day. And we will also provide water for the fire protection in case of an emergency in the energy center. Here are some of the design criteria that we use for the cooling towers, mainly Mason USA, and for the boilers, the American Society for Mechanical Engineers. And for drinking water, we use the EPA standards. In order to provide that energy center with 16.4 million gallons per day, we designed a vinyl filtration system, a backwash lagoon, a disinfection system, a reverse osmosis membrane system, and we also sized the pumps and pipes. As you can see here, we have two filtration systems, the reverse osmosis and the vinyl filtration. And the reason for that is that boilers require basically different water quality parameters than the cooling towers. So we had to include the membrane system just for the boilers. Therefore, all the 16.4 million gallons per day will go through the granular filtration, and then a portion of it, which is 0.65 million gallons per day, will go to the membrane system for total filtration. We'll start with the granular filtration, which basically uses four pressure filters. One will be used for redundancy. We are mainly treating iron and manganese, and every single unit will be able to produce about 6,500 gallons per minute. And as you can see, this is the pressure filter. Inside the pressure filter, there's a media that the water goes through, and all the contaminants are trapped in the media. After this media gets exhausted with contaminants, we basically backwash the filter and to get all the contaminants from the media, and all those contaminants will be dumped in the lagoon. The backwash generated from the tank is about 4,900 cubic foot. As you can see here, here's the lagoon, and the lagoon has a capacity of 10,500 cubic foot, so basically it can receive the backwash from two units in one day. And the water will infiltrate at 0.5 inch per hour per square foot, and the infiltrated volume is about 10,600 cubic foot per month. 106,000 cubic foot per month. And for the disinfection system, we designed a monthly storage disinfection system and also a daily storage tank. And we will be using 25% chlorine bleach to disinfect the water. For the membrane system, we will be using two systems. One will be used for redundancy. Each system will have a capacity of 600 gallons per minute, and our demand is about 542 gallons per minute. As you can see here, here's the layout of the whole system. Highlighted here is the building, and here's where the lagoon is located, and this is the storage tank for the cooling towers, and this is the storage tank for the boilers. The next slide is a close-up of this building. This is the layout. These four circles are the pressure filters. Here we have the disinfection system, and these rectangular shapes are the membrane system. The water will come in from the wells at this location. It will go through the pressure filters, and then it will exit at this location. A portion of it, like I mentioned before, which is about 0.65 million gallons per day, will go to the membrane system for further filtration, and then it will exit the building at this location, going to the tank. The remaining of the water will be disinfected at this location, and then it will exit the building and will go to the storage tank. And based on the flow rates, we sized the pumps and pipes to minimize the head loss in the system. I'm going to pass this to Brandon. He's going to be talking about the treatment and disposal of domestic wastewater.
As he said, my job was to treat, dispose, and partially reuse the wastewater produced on the site. You have two different types that are treated differently. You have black water, which comes from kitchen sinks and also toilets. And you have gray water, which comes from bathroom sinks and also showers. And here's this overall schematic of my design. You have gravity pipes here, here, and here, and you have the black water coming in here into its own septic tank, which then flows into a dosing chamber where it'll be pumped onto the mouth system. And you have the gray water system that flows into its own disinfection system, you know, into a storage tank where it'll be stored for later reuse for lawn irrigation and also toilet flushing. And this connection here to the mouth system was built for overflow purposes, for like in the winter months when the storage is not needed for lawn watering. And the valve here is to prevent backflow from when this water here is being pumped into the mouth. And for the black water system, we had a total daily demand of 792 gallons per day, which required a volume tank, a two compartment volume tank of about 2,500 gallons. And for the dosing chamber, it had a minimum of volume of about around 200 gallons. The dimensions are shown there. And also you can see also the dimensions of the piping needed. Here you have the 4-inch diameter of the graphene pipe, and then also have the 3-inch of the pressurized pipe. And also you have the mound system, total length of about 108 feet and a width of 42 feet, which I'll explain in the next slide. You have a centrifuge system where the perforated pipes come in through here and then spread out 20 feet in each direction. The meaning of the perforated pipes is that they have holes in them so that the wastewater will infiltrate into the soil. Here's another view of it. Here's the soil, the elevated soil on top of the already existing soil. Then you have the total cost of that black water system to be around $37,000. And then moving on to the gray water treatment system, you have a daily demand of about 720 gallons per day, which requires a volume of about 2,000 gallons for its own septic tank. And then you have a UV disinfection chamber that will treat the water here. You have just one left where the water flows in here, comes in contact with the left, which will kill any disinfectant or anything that will come in contact with it. And then as it flows on into the holding tank. The holding tank was designed for a minimum reserve storage volume of about 2,000 gallons, and also calculations based on how much was needed for the sprinklage. And that gave a total volume of about 5,000 gallons with a length of about 17 feet. And that came out to be around $30,000, which gave my total to be around $67,000 for both systems. And the reason we went with designing an on-site treatment for the wastewater instead of just sending it to the sewer system was to reduce the water bill and also eliminate sewer rates, which is the bill to connect into the public sewer main, and also eliminate that construction cost of connecting to the public sewer main. And also for sustainability, we want to give out the notion of conserving water and also reducing water demand, even though what we're doing is just a fraction of what needs to be done to conserve water on the planet. It will probably be a good idea for other projects to follow in the future. And now that's all for you. That's all about to do.
Thank you, Brandon.
Structural engineers should design 13,300 square feet one-story building and 500,000 gallons water storage tank. I'm responsible for one-story building structure. The scope is designing a building with office, maintenance equipment, and storage space. In my design, three alternatives were prepared, which were steel, concrete, and wood structure. The first alternative, steel structure, is widely used in America. It is cost-effective, light, easy to build, and long-term durability. However, it still has some problems. It needs high maintenance costs because of the corrosion, and it has low fire resistance. The second alternative is concrete structure. It has great fire and weather resistant, and it also has low maintenance cost. However, shrinkage is a serious problem. Shrinkage causes crack development and shrink loose. The last alternative is wood structure. It is fast and efficient to build. The greatest advantage of wood structure is sound absorption. Wood can absorb some noise which is created by machines. However, wood can burn easily. Wood with drying has is also a problem. The parameters which were considered for the evaluation of alternatives were safety, cost, aesthetic, recycling, open space, materials, lifespan, and fire resistance. This graph shows a comparison between these alternatives And finally, steel structural loop was the preferred alternative. Once the preferred alternative was decided, the building design will start. The design criteria I used for the steel structure were from American Society of Civil Engineers 716, International Building Code and Steel Construction Manual. Here are my assumptions. Based on the footprint area, the dimension of the building is 135 feet by 90 feet. According to the height of the vertical pressure filter, the building was 30 feet high. The self-weight of beam girders and columns are 8 tons per square foot. The life load is 20 tons per square foot and the wind stone load is 22 tons per square foot. For the wind load, I assume the average wind speed is approximately 140 miles per hour. Here is the plan view of the building. In the plan view, it shows the space between two neighboring beams is 9 feet and the space between two neighboring girders is 29 feet. All the beams, girders, columns, and braces shaped were designed in there. Finally, the total construction cost estimation is about $347,000, which includes beams, girders, columns, braces, insulation, ceiling, wall, and deck. Now I will hand it off to Leslie.
Adrian Stadium, my name is Leslie Manzano. I'm the second structural engineer for this project. So my main focus was to design a 500,000 gallon water storage tank. So the beginning of the semester, the school year, I mean, is that we have to choose between two alternative materials, either concrete or stainless steel. So for the concrete one, it's the least expensive due to the material that's mobile. So it would be easier shipping to the site. But it's just a disadvantage due to this area, because the freezing thaw, of course, winter, is not flexible. And the pores of the concrete will create bacteria buildup. And the life expectancy is only 15 years. So I chose the welded steel, and it is most cost effective because it has durability and just cracking and leaking and eco-friendly due to it can be recycled. And the life expectancy is 100 years. And the only disadvantage is if it's not coated correctly, it can leach calcium. So we have to make sure it's coated correctly. So the criteria that I used to design my tank was basically the same thing as the building. The only added one is the AWWA. To only focus on water storage tanks. So my water storage, which Jake has showed, the radius is 25 feet and the height is 57.5 feet with a 2.5 foot after your. So that just means that 2.5 feet are free. There's no water there unless our environmental people want to put more water in there so we can hold that. And due to the pressure of the water that's holding, the thing is holding, the steel of storage tank is a 1/4 inch, and the bottom of the storage tank is 5/16 inch. And of course, due to the region, it can withstand wind loading, snow, and live just for maintenance. So the total cost for all of this is $316,000. And the total cost for the whole project, with all the disciplines, is $5.6 million. So if I can... Okay, so due to time limitations, we're only allowed to answer 1 to 2 questions. Any questions?
Question for your treatment facility. Did you consider using bacteria?
Yeah, we could, yeah, that's part of one of the alternatives, but basically, I think it came down to, with that one, it came down to cost. We were trying to be the most cost efficient we can with the design, so we went with the ultra fire system instead of, I think it was, chlorine and a few others.
Any other questions?
if I understood correctly, ultimately the lagoon winds up with a very magnificent sludge of fire. How are you planning on disposing of that?
It will be filtered through the soil. So basically the water will be filtered through the soil. Any sludge that is in the lagoon can be removed and then treated somewhere else, and not at the location of the lagoon. Initially, we designed the lagoon so that the water will be evaporated, but that will make our lagoon size is really big because of the evaporation rates in the area. So we decided that to infiltrate the water, and the sludge can be removed.
The team consists of myself as the geotechnical engineer and project manager, Stephen Chen, I'm the hydrology engineer, Wen Yuan Zhen as the transportation engineer, and Dala as the structural engineer. So our project is actually happening right across the street from campus, in the area outlined by the red box there. The development area is about 12 acres, although the property is right in the And the clients are Valparaiso University and the City of Valparaiso. It's a joint project because both parties had requests for the project and the development of this property, although it is owned by the university. The objectives of the project were to construct a multi-use 2 to 3-story building to expand campus functions, as well as reducing and improving the local traffic in the area, and providing an access road between Sturdy Road and Still Heavy Road, which are right here and right here, as well as improving the pedestrian access to the entire property, now that there will be a building over there for student use, and reducing the stormwater runoff and improving its quality was a request made by the City of Valparaiso while we were developing this. So here are the key design components of our project. As you can see in the background, it is a schematic of the project. Here we have the building. So over here, to locate, is campus. We are about here in this building. And this intersection has been worked on to make it signalized, which it is not right now. But it will be signalized with pedestrian crosswalks, and the road will be then constructed across the property with a bioswale behind it in the green section right there. And then there will be a detention pond, and the parking lot has permanent location. And those are also aspects of the stormwater management portion of the project. So first, Dahl will talk about the structural design.
Okay, thank you. So I'm designing a two-story business incubator building. As you can see here, it's made of two sections. The first floor is about 22,000 square feet, and the second is 12,000 square feet. This section here is an assembly hall. Here the height of the floors is 13 feet each, but this section and this section is 18 feet in case of, like, they want more space to use for lighting and for sound. These are the designings that I used while designing my building. And those are the loads. I considered wind loading and seismic loading for the lateral forces and wind loading control. And for the other loads, I considered live load, snow load, and dead load, as you can see here. I started by designing the roof. It's only a metal duct with a bit of material on top of it to provide sound insulation, temperature heat insulation, and waterproofing. Here is the slab of the second floor. It's a composite section made of concrete and steel. It's lightweight concrete to minimize the load on the building. And this is here is the bracing for the wind loading. This is the schematic of my structure. These sections here is the joists that I use for the long span section. And those, the orange ones are the beams. The green ones are the girders, and these blocks are the columns. As you can see here for the second floor, there's more columns, and the spans are shorter because the loads are higher. So the building, the way it's set up, the slabs will transfer the load to the beams. The beams are then pin connected to the girders, which will transfer the load to the columns, and then will transfer it to the foundation. This is how the other bracing looks like. This elevation is for the assembly hall right here, and these are the two stories. Next, I will pass it on to Elena to talk about the foundation.
So, to hold up this building, of course, there needs to be a foundation. And before starting to design the foundation itself, I had to analyze the soil on the site to build the building. And so, we mostly have layers of clay. For the first about 5 feet, and then beneath that is layers of sand. So based on the soil at our site, I determined that spread footings, which look like this, would be the best type of foundation given the building loads, and would mainly because they would be the most cost-effective option. So the design steps for the footings were first to figure out the size, which is based on the loads from the building. Since there will be one footing beneath each column, that's how we determine how much weight each footing will have to hold. And based on how much weight the soil itself can hold, that determines the size of the footing, how far out it can spread the weight in order not to put too much pressure on the soil beneath it. And it is also controlled by the amount of settlement, so how much the footing will sink underneath that weight in the soil. So to minimize that to about only 1 inch under any particular footing was how I determined the footing size. After that, I determined the footing depth, as well as the steel reinforcement that goes inside the footing so that the footing itself, which is made of mostly of concrete, doesn't break. And on the right, you can see the standards that I used, similar to the structural design standards. So here's a layout. I plan at the foundation. As you can see, like, there's one footing under each column in the building, so it looks pretty similar. I highlighted in colors the different sizes of footings that I used based on the different loadings. If you remember the building, this center section has two floors, while the outer sections only have one taller floor. So the center section has a whole more load, and therefore the footings in orange are the largest footings, being 12 foot by 12 foot. Here's what a footing looks like from the side. This is a 10-foot footing, which were the ones in green. They all pretty much look the same, except for the size and the type of steel that's put into them. and they come up with this pedestal to meet the floor slab and the column of the first floor with a steel plate in between to even off the weight of the column on the top of the footing. And the slab goes right on the ground surface. You can see kind of where that lies. So an overview, the foundation consists of 43 footings. Here's some total quantities of concrete and steel. And the excavation volume is just all the soil that has to be dug up in order to place the footings. And then the backfill volume is the same soil we're going to take and put back and compact. So a little more will be used when you compact it. And then the slab can be laid, the concrete on the first floor. So next, Stephen will talk about hydrology design.
Hello everyone, I'm Ajovic Person for this project for stormwater management. In this project, according to our client, City of Alpresso, I designed tension pump for the 100 year and 24 hours flood control. I also designed valve wheel and permeable pocket knot. Permeable pocket knot for the 8% of the, to treat 8% of the rainfall. All the nine criteria I use here. The first one is the water resource and water technical manual. That's the most important one. And I also use the permeable interlocking concrete paper. And I also use the hydrology book, what we used and we learned in school. Okay, as what you can see, this is the permeable piping knot design. This is the hydrology analysis part. As what you can see, all the pipes are designed under the pumping space, and those pipes will be used to transport the water from the roof and also from the pumping, the driveway space, and transport all the waters into this catch basin. And the pipe, all the 6 inches diameter, and all the waters will be stored under the permeable pumping knot space. Maximum is 48 hours. This is structural analysis part for the parking lot. As what you can see here, the only parking space will be designed for the permeable, and they are divided into four layers. The first layer is the concrete paver, and the second layer is leveling cross, and the third layer is the base and the sub base. As what you can see, the pipe is 1 foot from the surface to the top of the pipe. Second is bios wheel design. The bios wheel will be located along the road that will be used to treat the suspended solid from the new connection road and also the oils, the cars, some kind of suspended solid from the side, from the road. As what you can see, the top width of the bios wheel is 3 feet and the bottom width is going to be 0.9 feet. And there will be a pipe, underneath the bios wheel, which is 1.5 diameter. And the soil type inside actually type C, which has a low infiltration rate. So I developed the soil on site to increase the infiltration rate. And as what you can see, this is going to be looking like on site. And finally, it's for the detention pond design. Detention pond design, after calculation for the site, the required water warning is like 300,000 cubic feet, which already plus 20% of the safety factor. And the detention pond I have designed, which is like 340,000 cubic feet, which is enough. And the depth of the detention pond is 4 feet, which plus, and also plus 1 foot of free wall. And for the design, also in this part, there will be an outlet to transport the water outside of the detention pond into the wetland in this area. Next, I will transportation person.
Hello everyone, I'm the transportation engineer. In this project, I'm responsible for design new connection road, intersection at 30 road and new road, also a parking lot. So right side is my design criteria for this project. Now I will talk about new connection road at first. The purpose of our new connection road is to reduce the traffic crash at these two intersections, also for people to get into the building. here is a general overview for my road connection road. Is that it is two-way road, and the road is 12 feet wide and around 2,600 feet long. The design speed of this road is 35 miles per hour. Here is the alignment design. The first one is plan view. As you can see, at this part, I keep the existing road to reduce the construction work. For the left part, I design a straight road. The second one is profile view. The straight line is the design road. This is the terrain view. As you can see, it's a flat terrain, so I design a flat road with a little bit slope. As you can see, here is a white line steep. The blue line is the white line, so I also design a cover. The cover is arch and open bottom covered with a corrugated steel. The span is 16 feet and the radius is around 5 feet. The design flow is 200 cubic feet per second. Here is the intersection design. After compared with several alternatives like roundabout and the stop sign, I finally decided to design a signalized intersection because it has a better level of service speed. Also, in order to reduce traffic jam, I also added two writing lines at here and here. Here is the parking lot design. I designed a 90-degree parking. So you can see here, and here is two entrance to our parking lot. And our parking lot is L-shaped, so I think 90-degree parking lot can make people more convenient to get into the parking lot. The parking lot is around 63,000 square feet, and we have 202 parking spaces, which includes 8 accessible parking spaces. They are all around the entrance to the building. Here is the pavement. All our pavement use asphalt pavement. It is half mixed asphalt. For the surface and under is used. This is, you can see, it actually is asphalt. It is 1 inch for the surface and 2 inch for the under. For this is the parking lot pavement, because it's similar just to this one. For the road is 1.5 inch for surface, 2.5 inch for under. For this and surface is totally 10 feet. That's all about transportation. Now I pass to project manager to talk about more about our project.
So the total cost estimate for the project is about $7.8 million. The design cost was estimated at $82,000, which is the work that we've done this whole year, and then the construction cost is the rest of that cost. So the impact of this project, as you may have noticed from our team motto, is to create sustainable and economical and environmentally friendly designs. So here are some of the expected impacts, mostly positive. So the one negative impact we got were the disturbances. But during construction, of course, there's noise and traffic backup because of equipment going down the street. But this will, of course, be temporary only during construction. So the rest of the impact of the project is expected to be positive, including the expansion of campus functions. And the assembly hall, we thought, would probably be used also for community functions or events, possibly hosting cultural events. The creation of new jobs due to the maintenance of the stormwater drainage design and the building operations. Improved traffic flow, it was also an original goal of the project. But the new road that we are building will also provide another access route to businesses on the other side of Still Heavy Road by the intersection with the new road. So the overall impact should be positive and we determined that it would be worthwhile for the given process. Thinking about the future, since there's a lot of space on this property, if the university wants to develop more, such as adding to the building or expanding the parking lot if necessary, there's definitely room to do that, as you can see here. Even more space before you come to the next house. And this space right here is currently used for some sports fields. However, if the university decides to move those, they could definitely develop that area of the property as well. And with development, further development of the property, if more stormwater runoff volume was needed, the drainage basin, which is over here, it's not really shown in the photo, but there's room to expand the drainage basin as well for any future development that could happen. So this concludes our presentation. My group will come up to answer just a few questions if you're running over time.
Congratulations, you're the first team that decided they should be paid.
Can you just explain your team name?
So, PCA kind of represents all of us because we have Abdel from Palestine, Luna and Stephen from China, and myself, I'm American. So.
Concludes our presentations. If you'd like to join us in the senior design space, you're welcome to do so. We have some refreshments. So thanks for coming today.
What's next?